Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This work session of the Hampton Municipal Budget Committee is called to order at
7 o'clock.
7 o'clock on December 1st, 2016. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The members of the committee will introduce themselves to you, starting on the viewer's right with the selectman representative.
Regina Barnes.
Michael Beers.
Sonny Kravitz.
Ryan Lopham.
Steve Henderson.
Mike Bluff.
Stephen LeBrange.
Jones.
Danielle Augustine.
David Maurer.
Bob Lay.
And our secretary is Barbara Kravitz. Please be cognizant of the microphones, because we do want the public to be able to hear you. And I think we're all set to go. Minutes first. Barbara has sent the minutes to everybody. And I will accept a motion to approve the minutes of November 10, 2016.
So motion.
Well, moved by Mr. Lapham, seconded by Mr. Pluff. We're going to have a very little pause to make sure Barbara can get that down. Okay. In favor of approving the minutes, has anyone any corrections, any problems?
There's one in here. Mr. Henderson's got a new first name.
He does?
I can't find it, but yeah. One of them, I saw it the other day.
Uh-huh.
I forgot to mark it. Michael Henderson.
Michael Henderson. It's right after the... Yeah.
16, the Lane Library. Down at the bottom, it says motion, Stephen LeBrange, second by Michael Henderson. So you can change your name or I'll drop out.
Our name was wrong.
It's on page 9 of 15.
Wait,
9 of 15?
Yes.
And then one correction on the front page, my dear, is Eileen Latimer's name is spelled incorrectly where it says selection of recording secretary. It's L-I-L-A-T-I-M-E-R. It's mer, not more.
Okay.
You ready to approve the minutes? In favor? Unanimous. All righty, the minutes of November 15th, moved by Mr. Pluff, seconded by Mr. Pierce.
Barbara, when did you mail those? I didn't see it.
You didn't do what?
I've sent the minutes to you.
I emailed them to everybody.
4 days ago, I received
them. Yeah.
At least
3 or 4 days, at least.
You have not received
them? No, I did. I received them a few days ago.
Yeah.
Yeah,
because I forwarded them all. All right. We have a motion to accept the minutes of November 15th. Are there any corrections? No, Mike Pierce seconded.
Okay.
All set? In favor of adopting the minutes of the 11th of the 15th of November? Thank you. Unanimous.
I abstain.
What? You're abstaining? You're abstaining? I'm sorry, Mr. Jones is abstaining.
Let me get that again. Who made the...
Pardon?
Who made the...
Mr. Pluff.
And I second it. Just in case.
Okay. Just a quick mention to you, ladies and gentlemen. I have revamped the schedule today for about the 8th time. I think what you have is the final schedule, but be sure you look in the bottom. For some reason, when I did the attachment on the first email, it picked up something else. So it should say revised December 1, 2016. and that will be the accurate schedule as far as I can tell. Now, tonight we have a discussion of the warrant articles that the Board of Selectmen reviewed, the proposed money articles. They reviewed at their November 28th meeting this past Monday. So we'll be going through those, but before we do, Mr. Jones has a comment on the IT committee and situation.
Oh, right. As you recall, we requested information relative to the ongoing IT audit report. It was responded to very well by management, and part of that response was that the IT audit report would be completed by the end of November. It is now the end of November, by being December 1st.
Mm-hmm.
And so I haven't seen anything, so I guess we need to formally ask for that audit report. So therefore I move that we ask for the audit report from town management.
So the chairman will ask the selectman representative to produce that report?
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Pierce. So that is the IT audit report.
You need to take a vote?
Yes, we will. I just want to make sure Barbara's able to get it, because sometimes we blabber on and I don't want to leave her behind. Okay, in favor of the request to ask for the IT report made by Mr. Jones, seconded by Mr. Pierce. Bob? Thank you. Okay, unanimous.
I have one other little thing I want to mention.
Got to have a microphone because you're so polite and you talk softly and in a dignified manner and people can't hear you.
I was been watching myself on TV and I hear myself just fine.
Yeah, I did too.
There must be people who need a hearing aid. Okay, just to straighten that out, I'll yell in this if you want me to. It didn't seem to make it any better, Mary Louise, when I was watching a rerun of Tuesday night's meeting. But anyway, I said I would do the default budget request.
Correct.
And I'd have it ready, but I haven't got it ready yet because I was fiddling with it today and my Excel spreadsheet and I decided to get into a fight. So the fight's not over yet, so it'll be ready for our next meeting, hopefully.
Okay. Well, we appreciate your work on that. Mr. Jones, and one final thing, you had some observation on the Budget Committee's budget?
Yeah, as you know, we tabled the Budget Committee's budget to a future meeting.
You mean the budget, just for the budget committee with
budget
the secretary
and budget.
And
yeah.
Okay.
That's right.
I don't know how else to describe it. It's the budget committee's budget.
Right. You're not talking the operating budget. You're talking the budget that pertains to the actual budget committee, paying the secretary, et cetera.
Right. That's what he's talking about.
I just want to make sure. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead.
Budget associated with expenses of this committee.
Yes.
What are we talking?
Thank you, Bob. For 2017, I had some thoughts on that I wanted to advance. I'd like to, for example, consider getting rid of the $300 training subline item that's there. As you know, or some of you don't, maybe a couple of years ago, we kind of changed that around because we learned that the NHMA, because of the enormity of the dues we pay them, entitles the town to a free seminar. For the last 2 years, we've been having them come in and give the entire committee a seminar for free, as opposed to sending only two or three people a year up to Manchester for a full day. And that's what that $300 was for. And I think it's maybe time to remove it, but there's some questions about that. Namely, will the Board of Selectmen, because they're the ones that can control how that free seminar is used, will the Board of Selectmen be inclined to continue that practice next year? If the message is yes, then I'm going to be inclined to get rid of that $300.
Madam Chair?
Perhaps, wait 1 second, smile at me. Perhaps Regina can help us?
I can ask my board.
That'd be great. That'd be super.
I mean, we've had it for the past 2 years,
right.
So.
Okay. And then we will know by the time we do the final review on the Budget Committee's budget and all the other budgets, we'll take it out or leave it in.
I'd like to make a point.
Yes, sir.
When you get on a committee the first time, Citizen Jones and myself went to the training session. It covers a lot of ground that they don't cover normally. You know, it gives you the total role of the budget committee, and they also give you the RSA 91A and all kinds of information that I think Tim found useful. I found useful.
Okay.
You know, when you're new to the committee,
yeah,
you don't know what the role really is, and that's...
Okay. I will make one comment there. I was very offended at, I believe it was the April meeting, when the representatives of the NHMA refused to take questions from the Budget Committee in public. And we went into what I felt was an illegal non-public session. I stated it at the time, and I say that again, and they were saying that they only represent the Board of Selectmen. If there had been a legal issue, that might have been appropriate, but there were no legal issues. They were just taking random questions from the members of the Budget Committee. And I am not happy with that attitude. So if that's the attitude they're going to take, let's do a little thinking about it. Okay.
I have one thing on
that. I'm sorry, Brian?
You need a motion on that before you move on?
Wait a minute. Brian has something.
If you want to make the motion, go ahead.
For that.
We don't need a motion. Regina's already...
She's going to check for us.
In the past, that $300 doesn't seem like much, but it's enough for two or three people to be able to take classes. We have some new members here.
Yeah.
And on top of what they've offered, this is how we've been doing it.
Yeah.
The last at least 3 years, that we would keep that money in there. And if someone or something happened and we need a class...
Well, they should be able to come down and address the entire Budget Committee.
Well, I'm not going to get into that. Right. But for $300, we can send a few people up there.
In some ways, better for everybody to hear all at once. Yeah. And because you don't...
Well, no, I don't disagree with that, but yeah. Most of us have already been through it.
Right.
So I'm just more thinking about the newer people, making sure they can get in and not have to come out of their pocket.
Yeah. Okay, well, hold that thought until we do our review. Mr. Jones just wanted to bring it up.
I'm just saying that's the idea behind this for the last 3 years.
So we can think about it. Mr. Pierce?
I was just going to say that maybe we should contact the Municipal Association to see if they're going to do that. No questions asked on TV.
Well, I don't know. Regina can ask, but it's highly unlikely that the Budget Committee is going to be asking a legal question. In other words, it's highly unlikely there's going to be some suit that's going to interest us where we'd be asking for legal opinion.
I didn't think that
but
was...
But not going behind closed doors and closing the public out with the excuse that they represent the Board of Selectmen and they can't give legal advice to anybody, and then they sit there and chit-chat for half an hour. So that was not appropriate. Okay, thank you. Now we are going to get some work done, Mr. LaRanche.
I have to talk about the basic law of budgeting.
Yes, sir.
That event that you're talking about is an all-day event, and I can remember when it was offered to me. I had no interest in spending an entire day over in Manchester. Instead, I was given this book, and it has everything in there.
Excellent.
I read it. I marked it up with things that I wanted to remember. This book has everything in there that you need to know.
Good.
If you can get a few of these books and hand
them
out
give
to
them out.
Some of these people, this has everything in there you need to know.
Stephen, when they come in, they pass out the book. What?
You're discussing exactly what I've mentioned to a couple of other people. I'm new.
This book.
All the stuff's going on, all these different meetings.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
And there's nothing all to give us that education. That would be great.
All in here. Every single thing you need to know.
Stephen, when they come in, they pass out a book to everybody, an updated new book.
I didn't go. And
they did.
Gave me this book. And
they
I read it at home in my own time, and it was a very... very wonderful experience.
Okay.
All things in here.
Excellent. Now, we are going
to get some of these books.
Mr. Henry. So I guess my question will be quick. Just is there some way that somebody here, representative, can get to the entry to get some books and then pass them on to the three of us or whoever needs them or doesn't.
You weren't here in April?
Actually, that the entire contents of the book, I believe, is on NHMA's website.
We don't want to print it out.
No, you can actually read it online.
Not to have him carry it around with me.
I thought you were more ecologically sensitive. I'm sorry.
Okay. All right, we're not going to be sitting here all night, gentlemen. Sorry. Pay attention. Okay, Regina, could you possibly inquire if the NHMA will just shoot three books in the mail down to us?
Okay, three
books. That would be very nice, so that Mr. Henderson, Mr. Maurer, and who else? And Danielle, okay. You weren't here in April?
No, we didn't receive one when they showed up.
I thought Nick gave us copies of it.
They gave a bunch of stuff. I don't think the book was in the book.
Okay.
Wasn't one of them.
All right, enough. Here we go. All right, Amanda Cooper is the librarian for the Town of Hampton at Lane Memorial Library, and she has presented one proposed special money article, and she was happy to discuss that with the selectmen Monday night, and she's here to help us out. So it's the bottom article. It says, add windows to the children's room at the library. Good evening, Amanda.
Hello.
Now, talk to us. Let's see. Oh, good. Now it says, shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $43,525 for the purpose of adding three new windows to the children's room of the Lane Memorial Library. This shall be a non-lapsing appropriation. Need to correct that. Get rid of the appropriating. Per RSA 32:7-6, and will not lapse until the purpose of this article is completed or by March 31st, 2019, whichever is sooner. May I make a suggestion? Because we're not going to finalize tonight. We're just reviewing and getting an explanation. Would you maybe add three new windows in the basement or the lower or the children's room, parenthesis, located in the basement? It'll give a little better context so people understand where you want to put these, because the average person looking at this would say windows. So just if you want to clarify, and then by the time we do our final review, it might be a little more specific. Talk to us.
Absolutely. So I mentioned when I was here on Monday night with the selectmen, since my arrival in the town as your librarian, the question of will we one day seek a new library or will we stay put where we are, to me has been settled. Our facility is wonderful. I have no intention of ever pursuing a new building. Whether or not augmented is another question. In the perfect world, the children would not be in the basement. That is just not, children aren't mushrooms. They need light, they need fresh air. It's a beautiful room, but it could use some help. The far wall that actually runs along the parking lot here, behind the rhododendron, it's sort of partitioned so that's five spaces. Three had HVAC equipment hanging from the ceiling in front of them, and two have windows. 2 years ago, when we refigured the HVAC equipment, we removed that from the ceiling, took it completely out, it's located somewhere entirely different, leaving those three spaces open for windows. So that's what we would like to do. The basement it's one-third above ground, two-thirds below ground. These will be one-third windows. We're not going to try to do window wells. I had Kevin Schultz look at that with me and discussed it, and it's definitely not a good idea. So, but it will give us a continuous wall, at least at eye level, and maybe a little above a light orange. So that's the intention.
What is the size of the window? That you're gonna you want to put in, how big are they? Height width.
I'm sorry. Say 2 to 3 feet high and very wide. I mean a good long width.
That's a good long width.
5 feet.
5 feet. You're talking 3x5 windows.
Yes.
Feet.
Yes.
Amanda, you mentioned stationary windows. They won't be open and closed.
They will be able to open and close. Absolutely. A smaller consideration that. Nonetheless, it's fairly important to us. In the children's room, there's no immediate emergency exit that leads you out of the building.
Yeah.
It leads you into other rooms and then to emergency exits.
Mm-hmm.
These three windows would be, with the addition of one of those temporary ladder things, you could go directly out of the window and be out of the building and away from whatever sort of threat might have popped up.
So the windows will kind of come open up.
So the two that are there now are the kind of lever up. I think these ones will go
Or sideways.
You can have a full open space.
Okay, yeah. Excellent. Further questions for Amanda? Stephen?
And there are no bushes or anything?
No, there's a good, wide-open, maintained space between the building and the next set of bushes. It's very clear.
Okay. Mr. Pierce, and then Mr. Kravitz.
So you don't need to have wells dug? So
not at all. No, it'll all be above ground, so there won't be any water issues.
Are there holes in the wall now? Or do you
have... There are some holes in the wall now because the HVAC equipment was there, so we're not penetrating brick that's been, you know, standing for 35 years. It already has an opening in it.
So there's no risk of weakening the wall?
No. Well, each of the people who helped us develop this budget included engineering work, so we can certainly review that before we move further. But with the openings that are already there, we feel pretty confident that we're not going to compromise the wall.
Okay. Thank you.
Sonny?
David, wait a minute.
Sonny, go ahead.
The only issue I have is you're aware of all the critical warrant articles for the infrastructure. You've got lots of trustee money. Be a good use of it. You've got a very expensive person, the IT, Bill Tessick, retired. You've got that money. You know, you could pay for it out of the library funds.
So the library funds, as they stand now, $117,474 in the trustees' accounts.
And how much savings would...
So that if we spent the trustee money, that we'd spend 37% of that whole fund, which is a significant chunk. It's also the only money the library has between disaster and whatever else may come. Any sort of unforeseen expense has to come out of that money. We cannot come to the town and ask for any sort of support. This is the money that keeps the library from having any dire circumstance. I would advance a proposal that spent 37% of that money. That just seems dangerous to me.
Good question. Okay. Mr. Maurer is next.
When you were talking about this window's already cut, you were talking maybe a 3x5, I understand that. Mm-hmm. So we won't be doing any jacking. You're going to be taking openings that are already existing. Is that correct?
So the openings that are there, it's venting for the HVAC equipment that was there. So there may be additional bricks around the venting to make the window as large as possible, but it is an established opening. Is that?
So it might be this big, and you may need to make it 5 feet wide?
I'm sorry I didn't bring measurements. I'd say the vents are fairly large. Say they're 2x4. It's really not, we're not going to be, it's not a minuscule size to a really large size. It really is pretty apples to apples in the size.
The reason I was asking some of these questions is the cost. Because I had windows replaced in my house, like 20 windows. Yeah. It was like $10,000. And you're talking three windows and it's 40-something thousand dollars. So the only thing I can come up with, the construction of cutting new openings and making sure that the structure, if it was a holding, or whatever they call it, a
load-bearing wall.
Thank you, load-bearing wall, that would be part of the cost being this high. Mm-hmm. That's where I was coming from. Can you answer any of that?
That interferes with the sound.
So the description of the masonry is that they're going to be cutting it out and reworking the opening. So it's... The openings are there, but there's going to be cutting involved of the brickwork, the CMUs that are there. Obviously, just the basic cost of the new frames. The engineering work to make sure that they're not compromising the building as they go along. Those are basically the three, in addition to labor, the breakouts for costs that I have.
Amanda, for our final review, if you might just bring copies of that description so we can look at it. I think that would be helpful because we're not going to make a decision tonight, but we just wanted to hear from you personally. Any other questions for Mrs. Cooper? Michael?
I'm following up on David's question. Outside walls, generally speaking, are load-bearing almost always. So I want to make sure that we don't have any 2x6s or whatever they might be holding up the floor. They're relying on that wall to keep the building up. So that's what I mean by, he means by load-bearing. Anyway, I'd be very concerned about that. So when you go through the process, make sure we take that into consideration.
Absolutely. I would not ever overcompromise the building. But the engineers that I spoke to, the construction people that I spoke to, felt confident that it was an achievable project and that I would consult with engineers before they move forward with
If they can put that in the little recap that you bring with you, that would be great. Okay, are we all set?
I just have one quick. Okay, so the engineering studies haven't been done yet?
Correct. They have not been done. We have a ballpark figure for what that would cost in this sum total of 43. It's included in that number.
Okay. Now, is there any money in your budget that can offset any portion of this?
So the budget that we receive is very regimented line item by line item what we're going to spend it for. There's not really... Our 2017 budget isn't even going up. We're asking for $400 more dollars from this year. We spend pretty much on the money.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
No, I guess you can answer your question.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. If everybody...
Hi, Amanda.
Did he adjust his seat?
I will have a good deal of difficulty casting my vote in favor of this for a couple of reasons. I don't find your argument compelling. The fact that it's subterranean and children aren't mushrooms, I would suggest that this is subterranean and adults are also not mushrooms. But we
are.
But we managed to survive, okay.
Mr. Jones, how many hours do you spend down here a day?
About 2 minutes.
I haven't...
Ask anyone.
I have a staff department down there, four people who work full-time scheduled hours, all below ground.
It'll cost
in addition to the children and the families that come to visit that space.
It'll cost a lot of money to treat them for depression.
Well, you know... I am trying to explain why I'm going to have difficulty with it. I'm not trying to have a debate about it. If you really need sun, you can get sun lamps. It'd be a lot cheaper than $43,000. You're talking nearly $15,000 per window. That just strikes me as absurd on its face. How long has that children's room been there?
1985, so.
So it's been there for a whole long time. 30 years, 31 years. And we haven't had any children committing suicide as a consequence of depression or anything like that, have we? So we've seen no ill effects. The children for 30 years have been enduring the existing environment with no ill effects, and suddenly now they're being depressed. It doesn't seem rational to me. And I'm going to have a difficulty with you. You argue that this provides a means of escape in case of an emergency. But it begs the question, is your 3-foot window sufficient to the building codes to constitute an egress? I suspect it does not. So to use it as use that as an argument as a means of egress is like kind of vacuous. So those are my difficulties.
Okay. Check with... building inspector on the size of the windows too. That might help before you come in again. Okay, are we all set? Because we have other things to do, and Amanda is all set, I think. Anything further to add? Okay, then thank you so much for joining us, and we'll look forward at the final review, and we'll take a look at your engineering
thank you
request. All righty. Familiar faces. Chris and Jennifer, come up and be friends. Were you able to come up with any kind of diagram or anything to show us? I had mentioned to Regina if we could maybe get a diagram showing where the lines are going and stuff.
Oh, good. Didn't get a response on that. I don't think it ever... I went through the chain of command, but...
Exactly.
But I'm sure we can come up with something.
Yeah, I was thinking if we could, for our final review, if you bring your computer and can show us, I think seeing sometimes helps.
Is the force main or Lafayette or both?
What? No, both. We know Lafayette. Just the pipes on 101 and all that stuff. I thought that might help.
Jennifer's had been out for a couple of days dealing with family issues.
Yes.
And I was in meetings all day yesterday
And you're so happy.
All day today, so.
You're so happy to be here tonight. Well, let's focus on the first one, which is the Church Street Force Main. And shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $3,207,100 for the purpose of constructing the necessary upgrades and replacements of the two old undersized wastewater force mains between the Church Street sewer pumping station and the wastewater treatment plant, The first force main is made of ductile iron and was installed in 1987 and failed in early 2016 and was repaired. The second force main is made of asbestos concrete and was installed in 1969. It is necessary to have both force mains operating during the summer to transport the normal sewerage flow to the wastewater treatment plant during 6 months of the year to prevent backup and overtopping of the sewer system at Hampton Beach. The force mains are to be constructed along State Highway 101 from the Church Street sewer pumping station to the wastewater treatment plant, therefore ceasing use of the aged and the inaccessible pipes that are located in the marsh. Such sum to be raised by the issuance of municipal bonds or notes for a period not to exceed 30 years under and in accordance with the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen and the Town Treasurer to issue and negotiate such bonds or notes and to determine the rate of interest thereon in accordance with the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for, contract for, accept, and expend any federal, state, or other available funds towards the project in accordance with the terms and conditions under which they are received, and to borrow in anticipation of the receipt of such funds and or the issuance of such bonds or notes as provided in the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, and to authorize participation in the State Revolving Fund, RSA 486:14, established for the purpose, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for, accept, and expend such monies as they become available from the federal and state governments, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to implement such cost-effective solutions as are presented in the future that they deem to be in the best interests of the town that may result in a lesser amount of expenditure than is authorized by this warrant article, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to take any and all actions necessary to carry out the project in the best interests of the town of Hampton. And there is a 3/5 vote required, as this would be a bond. One thing, Chris or Jen, that might help to start us out, do you explain what happens to the old lines? How you disable, disconnect, whatever you do with the old lines?
Well, anything other than just filling them with some concrete to seal them off would require a wetlands permit, disturbance of the wetlands, and would probably be taken with a very dim view by the Wetlands Bureau. So probably, and I can check with the engineers to make sure that that's the line that we're going, but at such time that we're reasonably assured that the new construction works well, that is the normal procedure. It's just, we'll dig it up on our side
on the treatment plant
side and the Church Street side, and
basically
pour in some what they call flowable fill, which is just really loose concrete.
Cap the lines and...
We basically just use the concrete.
And
Once it's plugged, it's plugged.
So they will be disabled.
Yeah, they'd be disconnected. Yeah. Right.
Okay. Well, I just thought
so we're coming into the plant in a whole different direction. We're coming down Tide Mill Road. We're following across the parking lot for the transfer station into the plant.
Yeah.
Because that is the Tide Mill line route.
That's where the diagram will help when we do our final. Okay.
To be honest with you, some of that is still up in the air. After I left here Tuesday night, Wednesday, noontime.
Whenever it was.
I was over at the engineer's office. They were going over the borings that they had encountered. They redefined the route, if you will, or gotten it firmer. But they also did say that next week they have, I think it's on Thursday, so was it Thursday today? It's a blur. They have a walk with the DOT to actually, put grade stake in, said we agree on this location, we agree on that location, etc., all for the whole length. At least what's in the DOT's right-of-way. Also got disclosed on Wednesday, we had always thought that we could hang these two pipes off of the bridge structure. It would save us from having to build our own bridge. That can't happen.
Mm-hmm.
And to find out they've got cross bracing under the bridge, and where we'd need to core through each abutment. We'd actually be coring into a solid concrete slab almost 20 to 30 feet deep, as in away from the bridge. So it's more costly, but we're going to end up with our own bridge parallel to theirs. The good thing concession from DOT was we can build our bridge basically on their wing walls, utilizing their foundation and the other concrete that they already have in there. There is sufficient carrying capacity for that, but we will essentially end up with our own bridge.
Bridge as like
over the creek,
cars and trucks and
no the
people or
carry may the pipe. Have
just
may,
to carry the pipe
if there's money allowed, and it'll be an option in the bid, but I may deck it and turn it into a footbridge.
Okay.
So that bicyclists
just
or joggers
case.
Or walkers.
Yeah.
Because we do see or encounter a number of people traversing that 101 corridor,
okay,
either by bicycle or by foot. Especially visitors from overseas who only have bicycles to get to Hannaford or the Banks.
Yeah.
Is a common occurrence.
Okay. How comfortable are you with the total? And I have to tell you, I'm chuckling at the $100.
No, there's a new price. We're going to ask for, or I have the estimate as of yesterday.
Oh, good grief. Okay, go for it.
Glad you asked.
Keep me on the right page.
So it's gone down a couple
million?
Oh,
yes. Well,
good.
You can flip a
good
figure or two. $4,242,000.
And we got rid of the $100.
Yeah, we saved
that. Well, $1 million.
Can you repeat that?
$4,242,000. Right.
I think it's important to understand that there's always been a range that the engineers provide for you. You get to these final numbers as you go through the design. So as you've done the borings, find out where the rock is, find out where the bad soils are, find out that you need your own bridge, find out that you're taking a few more turns than you did. That's why prices change from conceptual as we go through.
So we went up $1 million, and I'm hearing that that's still not the final numbers, all right?
We are at almost 70% drawings at this
70%
point.
70% drawings. What?
So it's not a final number either.
Right.
The final number will be whatever. Well, this is what we'd be requesting to borrow. And just like in the Church Street pump station, they estimated something like $4 million. And
came
we got
in under.
2.5 or something.
Mm-hmm.
That has to do with how the various contractors approached the job, who really needed the work, etc.
How they look at dewatering. That was one of the major savings for the pump station. And again, one of the things they're estimating is a high cost, but if something comes in or someone comes in with a different solution, that can bring down the cost.
What we found from the borings is 101's 4 feet of stable fill, but it sits on pure muck.
Yeah.
Lack of a better technical term.
Yeah.
We traditionally, by the state rules, like to bury the pipe with 4 feet of cover.
Mm-hmm.
For frost reasons, especially out there with the wind whipping across it. So part of what the estimate has picked up is if we keep it at 4 feet, we're having to over-excavate 1 to 2 feet of muck, that whole 1,500 feet. Also, it has to be dewatered because if they are just like a Church Street pump station, when the tide came in, they found water was, I was like, yeah, I could have told you that was going to happen. That, you know, tide comes in, water comes in. So those two things have driven up the cost, and the only significant ledge that we've encountered is when we're making the transition from 101 over to Tide Mill Road. That's it.
How far, once you get past the bridge, across the causeway, how far up are you going? You're not going to go all the way up to the light. Are you going to go across it like the St. James?
No, if you can envision, and we'll have this diagram for you, but if you're standing on 101, and if you were to turn left in the Masonic Lodge, the white building,
the St. James.
You know, you're now facing it. So there's also a cell tower
right
there.
Mm-hmm.
Right. We'd be cutting across straight there, so
that's
not going up and coming back down around.
That's what I want.
Literally get over the causeway so we don't have to be in the marsh at all.
Good.
No directional boring. All areas that are obtainable by normal equipment.
Would it be ground level at that point?
Everything
will
be
subgrade. It'll be 7-8 feet below the ground because the cell tower is actually higher, so if you maintain 4 feet of cover. We actually start to be gravity right there on 101. We start marching due east.
Why can't the pipe be ground level?
It would freeze.
What if you had it insulated?
It's not general sewer practice to have it.
It's not, yeah. The state won't approve it. Their desired cover is 6 feet.
Yeah.
They'll live with 4 feet on a cross-country line.
Well, so theoretically, we could put it at present ground level and then add 6 feet of dirt on top of that, right?
And then when you have runoff off of 101, what do I do with it? Because it would get trapped.
Well, we'd have to do something to keep the soil in place. I'm just wondering if that would improve the cost factor.
Well,
because, you know, digging in all that muck is going to be very expensive, right?
Yeah, but it's the pipe. When you cut the muck layer, the pipe's actually going to be right there at the muck layer. To support the pipe, they have to overdig 2 feet, put in some crushed stone. We have to wrap it in fabric, because if we don't, it'll settle. And then we move on.
The alternative is to put up ground, throw some dirt on top of it, and a nice sidewalk on top of that for our tourists to enjoy.
DOT wouldn't tolerate it.
Well, at least
what are you doing? It goes over
Stephen,
the bridge.
Hey, gentlemen.
Over the bridge?
Under
gentlemen.
The bridge, alongside it.
Yeah.
How do
Stephen,
you explain that?
Yes, gentlemen, sir. We need hands.
Mr.
Kravitz has been waiting to be recognized.
I'm sorry, Sonny.
Hands will help. Okay? Sonny, go ahead. Wait a minute. I'll get to you in a minute.
All hands on deck.
As I look at the Warren article from the voters' point of view, they're going to see the price tag, and they're not going to read the legalese.
Sure.
You know what I mean? You have to make a sale at the beginning. Explain how critical it is and the consequences if you don't. You have to speak in English. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Otherwise,
you have to express the reality.
Otherwise, you're not going to make a sale.
Right. I understand. Thank you.
Okay, Steve?
You were talking about the pipe freezing. So what do you do when you go the expanse across the water?
It is wrapped in about 4 to 6 inches of what they call pipe wrap or an insulation.
So it won't freeze.
On the right. Aquarians, water pipes, the gas companies' pipes, even electrical lines, they'll sheathe in pipe insulation
to
keep the temperature more constant.
Yeah.
And they do that just to understand it because general engineering practices keep it underneath. You can do it for a short spell, like anything else. It's longer in there, exposed, it gets cold. You can do it for short spells, but that's why it goes back there.
Okay, Bob?
Having a 9 sea level rise, do you have to build sustainability into the project to get federal money?
Yes and no. I hate to put it that too, because I hate when lawyers do it to me. We have to show not only to the state the design, but the U.S. Army Corps, because of the bridge and the tidal creek crossing in its proximity to the wetlands. We also have to show the coastal program. They're another division of the state, and there's another division that I'm forgetting. Thank you.
Natural heritage.
Natural heritage.
I think everybody's going to have a piece of the pie.
They make us take into consideration the rise, and especially the coastal people make us take into account the rise or the potential rise in the sea level.
So you are factoring that into the
Yes. Problem. Matter of fact, that's part of the, when we cross parallel to the bridge, that's where the U.S. Army Corps gets into it. They want to make sure that, the kayakers and rowboat enthusiasts can still get under the bridge. We can't be any lower than the deck, the structural steel that's already there.
Yeah.
We can't further impede the flow of vehicle or water. Vessels, I should say, or water.
Okay.
Yes, it's taken into account.
Brian has a question.
When do we think this will be completed?
The discussion Wednesday was that the end of December, but it could be like, well, do you mean, I'm thinking design, did you mean construction?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. We have a drop dead date of October of 17.
Because one thing the school ran into, and I'm just passing this along, is the cost of materials skyrocketed this year. And the longer we are, you know, we need concrete, etc.
Probably the biggest price fluctuation that could possibly occur is to the plastic pipe. The high-density polyethylene pipe.
Yeah. All right, so this will be covered in that fixed cost.
Stable oil market, there should be no, right.
Thank you.
Go ahead, Jen.
I just think it's important to note the schedule that we're looking at. I mean, by the end of December, and here's where I may get corrected, because I was not at yesterday's meeting, you know, is to actually have documents ready to bid so that we get bid actual prices, so that we know what it would cost to do this project, go into March meeting, come out with a favorable vote, and sign contracts, and then have the drop-dead end of construction lines in the ground end of October.
By the time... Wait a minute, where did the hands go?
Right here.
Yeah, well, by the time we get to the public hearing in January, you'll have a chance to adapt if you need to make an amendment, whatever, yes, if you need to. And... Yeah, and I, well, I'm just looking here. And I think it is really, really critical at the public hearing, have that design up at the town meeting. I think it's hard for an average person like me to visualize what you're doing. And I think it will be a tremendous help if we can actually see what, where, how. Give us some parameters. Now, Mr. Jones, who had both hands up.
When will you have the bids?
We hope to have a bid in hand prior to the March vote, so that, I want to say, first week of March, we can announce to you, we can announce to the papers, whatever, this is what the actual number came in. Because I think a lot of voters want to know, with some relative certainty, you know, we're not writing a blank check. This isn't going to be a $6 million job, is it? You know what I'm saying?
Chris, I think the concern that I have, and I think Mary Louise was indirectly expressing, is that we put a Warren article out there. Mm-hmm. We have a January 12 public hearing meeting. Mm-hmm. And the Warren article is going to be difficult to change after that date. I wouldn't say impossible, but it kind of...
I asked them, if at all possible, advertise this, and can we have a bid closing for the deliberative session. They're working hard to do that.
So even that's question.
Well, you better have.
That is question.
You'll be,
If I could have gotten a...
But you absolutely cannot change that after deliberative session.
After, right, deliberative session.
So even that means that
Wait
we're...
One second.
Even that means we're still looking at an uncertain number. The voters may very well be looking at an uncertain number.
With this... price that they...
It's possible, is all I'm saying.
Right. I mean, anything's possible, but this is the same firm that did the Church Street project. They gave us a price then that included the proper amount of contingencies, and they've done the same thing here.
I want to make a statement on my evolving thoughts on this, and I'll do it as briefly as possible, Madam Chair. I believe that this approach is the approach that should have been done right from the beginning. The first pipe went in 1969, right?
Yes.
And that's when it should have been done more or less this way in 1969. It was done the way it is now.
Well, 101 was not there.
Right.
They didn't have a road to do it on.
I believe you're trying to say it should not have been buried 7 feet under a marsh.
Yeah, and I'm hearing we're still going to do some burying,
right?
Even as it is, and that's why I was asking about the above ground scenario, because
burying in the driveway.
Well, because part of the reason I was asking that is we're spending a lot of money digging when really we get nothing out of the digging that we might not gain by putting it above ground. Maybe we can get a dual purpose of a sidewalk there on top of it, you know, kind of thing.
And that's why I was asking about it. I'm not an engineer. I can't say I want that or anything like that.
Okay. Mr. Moore?
Excuse me. I'm not done. My concern is that we know that if we get a repeat, and it's very iffy. No one knows whether or not we're going to get a repeat of what we had earlier this year, right? We had one rock under one pipe, the newer pipe, actually, and over time it kind of wore and rusted through. Right? The other pipe is like solid, as far as we can tell. I mean, it's concrete encased asbestos, right? Is that what it is?
You can ask Mike, he'll tell you how brittle it is. It's, if you touch it, at the age that it got installed now, if I were to touch it with a piece of a shovel, it would probably break. Mm.
Okay, so we know that even though we may not be at risk for the same problem, that there may be others that are developing. Mm-hmm. In fact, we know others are developing, we just don't know when they're going to be realized.
Right.
Old so is old.
Yeah.
Mr. Maurer?
I'm not done yet.
You're not done yet.
So the difficulty I'm having is just what is the risk, not what happens in terms of you're going to have to shut down toilets on the beach. I realize that's the net effect, right? But what's the chance of that happening in the next year, next 10 years, that kind of thing? There's no way anyone can answer that. So that's, I'm like, okay, I got this unknown risk thing going on here in my head. How do I evaluate the risk-reward factor? See what I'm saying?
Being the public works director comes with a crystal ball.
Did you raise your hand, Madam Chair?
Are you almost set? Because
I've had enough.
Others in line. Mr. Maurer, sir?
You have a contingency plan. This is a warrant article, as I understand it. It'll be voted on by the voters, as I understand it.
Right.
Let's assume the voters, for my scenario, turn it down. So therefore, we would have at least another year, because we don't know whether there's another rock there. It might happen in 2 months, 2 days, or 20 years. I'm thinking of a possibility, in case it did go down that route, a contingency plan for whatever it costs you to fix this one. I'll make up a number here, $200,000, probably less. Putting $200,000 to the side, then in case it ever broke for a second time, it's almost like having four tires in your car. You have a brand new car, they get a flat tire, you don't buy four new tires. Except for an all-wheel drive car, maybe. But that's where I'm kind of thinking. But if they do turn it down and it's really needed, do we have money set aside to repair it in case it breaks if the warrant doesn't pass? Does that make any sense at all?
It does. And there's two answers that we want to give you, and Jen's prepared for one of them. Just like this year, for instance, I have a sewer repair line or sewer maintenance line of $130,000. We committed all of that line to, that whole budget line to this repair. Plus I had to commit other funds in case there were cost overruns. We committed basically a total of $180,000 in the end. And Jennifer's brought the numbers today. She can actually tell you to the cent what we spent road-wise and cost-wise. So no, just like an abnormal snow year, or if this occurs again, I just basically raid the budget. And when I do, things like outside training cease, other sewer repairs cease. Like, for instance, Ann's Lane was on the schedule this year. It didn't get done. Manchester Street was on the schedule. It did not get done. That got postponed because I can't, from the state's perspective and the EPA's perspective, I can't not correct that situation. If the decision's made not to go in there for a second time, is there alternatives? Yes. Jen, and we have prepared different contingencies. They're not inexpensive. Do you remember? There was overland piping was one, but it's only good until, it would only get us through the summer season. It would
freeze. We have an emergency piping plan with a potential vendor that would be able to come in here over 7 to 10 days time, bring in temporary pipe, fuse it all together, run it down the side of 101, go through the permits and that would be during the summertime if we couldn't just live on the one pipe. Yeah. If one pipe is still functioning, we could go back out in the marsh again. Keep in mind, $8,700 and something for the parts. $130,000 to get there to fix it. So it's the rating of the budget. There's ways to deal with it if we need another pipe going, but none of them are inexpensive.
And understanding the time that it would take us to mobilize to get out there, week and a half, that there would be an economic impact.
Well, based on the last one, which I don't know that much about, honest to be honest with you, but it broke. I heard there's a rock underneath. So between the time it broke, and then I heard possibly maybe within 3 days or a week, how much time did it take you? Because obviously you fixed it and did a good job, because the problem went away, that problem went away. What was the time sequence of that, and what did that cost?
We were notified, I think we found it about the 3rd, and I think it was finally fixed March 20th, 19th or 20th.
So it's almost 3 weeks.
Like almost 3 weeks.
Yeah. Okay. It had been leaking
for we don't know
December how. Probably.
But they found it quickly.
Yeah. Okay, wait a minute. Wait. Okay, Steve had his hand up, and then Regina.
Thank you.
You see the hand?
No.
So we have two pipes right now. One's the asbestos cement was from 1969, so almost 50 years ago. And then you have an iron pipe. Was that 30 years ago or something? So what are the widths of those pipes?
Diameter,
I'm sorry.
14 inches.
14 inches each one. So the new pipe is going to be just one pipe, correct?
No, two.
Well, it's going to be two as well.
216.
Oh, okay. So that you have, if one, then you still have one other.
Right, and the reason for having them parallel to 101 is about halfway down from Church Street pump station to the bridge, I'm going to have access to a manhole to clean the lines. And how we clean the lines is we send in what we call a pig, a balloon. It could also be a wedge of ice, an ice plug. And we'll push it under pressure, and we literally can clean the line. Then once we have it clean, we can actually inspect it. So that's been one of the problems all along with the line underneath the marsh. Nobody had a camera with a 4,000-foot long lens.
Yep.
Nobody had the capability to actually jet and clean a 4,000-foot line.
That was willing to take the risk all on their own, i.e. it gets stuck. We own their very, very extensive camera, and we're going out to the marsh to break the pipe to get it back. Or buy them a new one.
And so now these two pipes, what are they made of? Because are they going to last far? What's their life expectancy?
Have you ever seen any of the gas companies work that goes in and they'll have a very thick black or sometimes yellow?
I've seen the black pipe that they use.
Then you've seen it.
What is that made out of?
High density polyethylene.
And so that has a life expectancy that perhaps 50 years or...
Well, in laboratory tests, they put it through, you put it through accelerated seasonal changes. They're out in the area of 100 years.
Better than what we've got. Right?
And it becomes a continuous pipe without joints, because they literally, somebody fuses in the field that pipe right together. And then it's actually air tested or pressure tested. It can even be x-rayed to make sure that there's no defects in the fusing that was actually done. But that's what the gas industry uses and the water industry now.
Okay, so you're using the best that we can put out there for now.
Right.
The best there is for now.
The best technology. Okay. All right, thank you very much.
Okay, Regina?
Okay, I'm going to ask Jen my favorite question about how much it costs us, and I think you said it a few minutes ago, but I'm going to ask it again, to go out onto that marsh to get down and figure out what was wrong with the pipe.
It cost us $128,000.
Okay, thank you very much. And now, to stem off of what you said about the quality of the pipe that would get installed, mm-hmm. I think the biggest advantage of the new pipes would be that our Public Works Department could actually get to them, mm-hmm. maintain them, get down there via a manhole or whatever they need, how they do it. Mm-hmm. Right now, there's no way. They're just sitting out there in salt water, and we can't see them.
Yep.
It's dangerous. To me, it's the number one priority for this March town meeting, are these pipes and the one on Lafayette Road as well. It can't be pushed down the road anymore. And I'm going to read a couple lines. This is draft. It's a draft order from New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services. It's draft, so I don't want to get into the details, but I'm just going to read a couple lines. Hampton shall include, with the plan submitted for approval, an implementation schedule with milestones and final construction completion date no later than October 30th, 2017. So, and then one more line. Failure to secure funding for the required actions or failure of a consultant to meet deadlines in and of itself shall not be construed as beyond the control of the town of Hampton. So to me, this is something that needs to get done for the sustainability of the town, which I would like to reiterate is the main reason why I did this job. The main number one reason why I'm 39 years old and I'm on the Board of Selectmen. So I think our job as a budget committee is to make sure that the public knows the situation, how we have to wait for Chris to get the final, you know, bids, how just we just have to let them know the whole process, like we're getting explained right now, and we just have to show them how important it is for this town.
Mike?
Yes, I had a couple of questions, actually. When you were out repairing the pipe in the middle of the marsh, it cost you $130,000 to get out there. Why didn't you inspect going both ways with your inspection cameras and then also inspect from both ends? And you could cover probably 90-some percent of the whole length of the pipe.
Got it. We did have Ted Berry Company standing by that morning to do just that. When we opened up the pipe, the lower third of the pipe was full of stone that had literally sucked it in. It was down the pipe as far as you could see. When we looked back up the pipe with some pretty strong lights, it was one-third full as far as we could see. For them to inspect, they would have had to remove all that material. So the question and the value decision was made at that point, do we want to leave this hole open for a week while we try and clean and then video inspect? Will we end up with anything? I made the decision with the support of one of the selectmen that was out there not to do that. We needed to get this back online, back in service. And one of the things we did look at while we were there is there's an outside cement lining on the pipe, and there's also an inside cement lining. In both instances, the lining, the cement coating, was in fact intact, which tells me that it was not an internal corrosion problem. That's what we would have been able to try and figure out with the camera. That's all it would have told us. Or it would have seen another couple of stones up under some other joint somewhere else. The other thing is, where the break occurred was at one of the first major crossings, i.e. in another 50 feet, you were going to be in 10 feet of water. So the pipe literally has dove under that point, and probably that saddle on that pocket down below is half full or even three-quarter full of stone and muck. So we'd never get it out. So we could literally only go 50 feet that way, and going back that way, we couldn't see anything that visually would let us to believe that there was a problem.
Well, the other question I have is along that same line is, there's, from what I understand, there's a radar type device you could actually go along the pipe.
But it has to be cleaned first.
Yeah, but you're not going to be looking inside the pipe, you're going to be looking at the outside to see if there's any rocks poking it up from the bottom. And if our theory is one of the
theories... What do you mean, radar from like the top?
Yeah, from the
top. But it won't see below the pipe.
Well, you do it at two angles, one on one side and one on the other side, and you can see basically almost under the pipe, except maybe something immediately under, which would have to be small. And the reason why I ask that question is because that might eliminate the possibility of stones poking through any place else. And if everybody says that there should not have been any stones in it, it was some kind of a construction mistake... If that's true, and there's only one stone poking the pipe in the whole thing, one could argue the fix in the pipe will last for a long time.
Well, we did take the step before we pulled the mat, and by the way, we didn't build a road. We rented what, $80,000? That's it. They actually make floatable mats. They're about 4 to 6 inches thick. They have air pockets in them. It was amazing to see two of them laid down on a piece of equipment that weighs close to 100,000 pounds right across it, and all of us not sink out of sight. We did leave those in. We had a cap put on the Church Street Force main side and a cap put on our side, brought it up to 5 pounds of pressure, and it held for 3 days. That tells us that there were, at this point in time, and there may be one below that muck that's in the bottom of the pipe, but there was nothing catastrophic to not put that pipe back in service. We're also taking the additional process agreed with the state that we regularly conduct that same pressure test right now as one of our operational standards. So we're still testing the pipe the best we can with basically liquid pressure.
So you never have looked at around the pipe to see
that
with a radar device, okay?
Right.
Because that was brought to my attention by somebody that was familiar with this sort of thing, because I'm really not familiar with the pipe.
We had people call us from, like, Iceland, Great Britain, all of, engineering firms on the West Coast. Hey, we can send a device down through, and it basically is a interior radar unit, and it looks at the signal that it gets for the magnetic response, if you will. Yeah, okay. You got to clean it first? Yeah. Okay, we have 2 11-degree bends in it. Oh, that'll be a problem. We got to go out there and dig into those pipes. And then we'd ask the question, what are you going to do when the tide comes in? It's tidal?
Yeah.
It's tidal? That's why it was such a pain to get to. Oh, that's a problem. Yeah. Well,
They couldn't use a radar device to go along on top of the ground, though, and do it. Nobody offered to do that.
Okay. Sonny?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I have to reiterate, you know, the number of people that watch TV and the meetings, you have to really get it out to the public. And I would change the wording of the language to explain that if we don't do it, the EPA is going to be all over you and the beach will be closed down. You know, it's the only, you know, there's no other way to reach the voters.
But at the same time, we've been cautioned, don't, the words we use, don't threaten the public. Don't have a fire and brimstone sermon type of thing. Just try and stick with the facts.
It'll be explained.
We will, definitely for the deliberative sessions, have a PowerPoint presentation, and we can wrap that presentation up and put it on Channel 22.
Because if you read the Warren article, you're not going to get all the way through it.
And a lot of people are already cognizant. I had supper at downtown, and the conversation, what do you do for work, Chris? I'm the public works director. Quietly trying to enjoy my meal. Oh, and to the person in the restaurant, hey, this is the public works director. And then they all know about it.
They'll learn you.
They all know about it. So...
Wait a minute, Brian.
We'll find out.
Okay. I just want to point out a couple of things, and Brian is next in line. Did you take any pictures?
Of the repair?
Yeah, when you had the hole open.
They're posted online, and we can bring them in. Yeah.
Yes. Number two, I live in...
a section of pipe that's broken, by the way.
Yeah.
It sits over at the Church Street pump station.
Well, I mean, seeing helps,
I think. And the stone's there, too.
Visual aids. Now... I live on Little River Road, and we have sewer, thank God. How far apart are the manholes?
State requirements. Maximum they can be is 300 feet.
So when Toby comes with sewer and drain and he needs to look in the sewer line on Little River Road, he lifts up a manhole and puts the camera down.
After they clean it, yeah.
So that's the regular way that you do that. What's happening when the effluent gets to the wastewater treatment plant? It must be carrying some of the sand and grit with it. What's it doing to the plant?
Well, in the headworks, there's a
the filter.
There's actually a, you know, it literally flows in and can literally settle out.
Yeah.
We have a bar rack where we catch bigger things like bathing suits and towels, but the grit and any stone will actually settle to the bottom, and there's actually like a chain pulley system. It keeps going down to the bottom, lifting up the grit, and we actually have a grit container inside that building, and it deposits the grit in there, and once a month it goes off to the landfill.
Okay.
So we do capture it, but that isn't to say that we get it all. Some of the fine suspended grit is still, it's just a normal function of wastewater,
mm-hmm.
even for non-beach communities, to have some amount of grit.
Okay.
It's Brian? Fine grit.
Did you try any dye?
Brian, put your hand down.
Dye to do
to run through the pipes?
Not after it passed the pressure test, no.
Okay.
I mean, we use dye regularly. We drop it in service locations to see which manhole it comes out in to make sure that, hey, it's still flowing downhill. But how we found this was we used a natural dye.
Okay.
Corn. When we went out there, there was the hole. We went, took the walk on February 2nd, and there was a hole in the marsh, and it was the perimeter was lined with corn, undigested corn.
Yeah.
We said, huh, that's interesting. Where would that have come from?
Mm.
So we told them to turn the pump on, and the hole started bubbling. Shut the pump off. We found it.
Good thinking. Thank you.
The corn gave it away.
Yeah.
Jen, when you guys are through with all this, I complimented you on the job that was done on the drainage on High Street. And the first thing I think I said to you was, please, please save the records.
Mm-hmm.
So that 20 years from now, whoever's in Public Works, bless their hearts, will need an accurate record. And we have had problems in the past with having accurate records of what was done.
Mm-hmm.
So the poor souls running the department can figure out what's going on. I'm assuming that that will be the case here, and you guys will be keeping a complete documented yep. record of what went where and how and all that stuff.
Definitely.
Okay.
The state wants us to give them an as-built.
Excellent.
In their quarter. By the way, the other day, we don't throw anything out. We just found the 1933 plans for when the pump station originally on the beach pushed in a single line across the marsh in a totally different line, only an 8-inch line that was encased in concrete.
Oh my.
So that's still out, most for the most part, still out there.
And one more second, Tim, and then I'll recognize you. And this is probably more appropriate for Fred. What is the real chance of getting the SRF funding? What are they doing up in Concord?
Yeah, there's a bill in the legislature to allow funding of SRF funds. We'll see what happens with it in this session. The state's anxious to have us do this, and they're anxious. In the past, when they've been anxious, they have pledged the money, and we've actually got the contract done, and they've actually paid it.
Now, if this is approved, and we can go for the SRF funding, we don't have to start paying back until a year after the project is completed?
That's correct.
So it's unlikely. What would the interest hit in 2017? Just give us a little frame.
No, it's going to be 2018.
It will be 2018.
That's
so
correct.
If this is approved at the 20...
It'll be late 2018.
Okay, at the 2017
yeah.
town meeting, we would be looking on into almost 2 years, at least a year and a half, perhaps, before the payments would have to commence.
That's correct.
Okay. Now, Mr. Jones?
We have a 14-inch pipe, two of them in?
Two 16s.
Two 16s.
Two existing 14s, proposing two 16s.
Sorry. All right, that was the other half of my question.
Okay.
Why not go bigger? Maybe that's the ideal 16, I don't know.
We have, matter of fact, when meeting with him yesterday, if I go bigger, the velocity in the pipe slows down.
Okay.
I could end up leaving stuff in the bottom of the pipe.
Better.
One, there's a, your minimum velocity is about 2 feet per second. Your maximum velocity, you don't really want it much over eight. Much over eight, if there's any grit in there, you start scouring. It's like a sandblasting process.
Okay.
Lower than 2, things tend to settle out. And you don't want that either.
But we are going up 2 inches, so that's going to affect the velocity. Apparently.
Plus, the other thing is the inside of that pipe is a lot smoother.
Smoother.
It has a more slippery, if for a non-technical
more slick.
Term. Yeah. Slick. It's actually, its end factor is higher.
You just got technical again.
I know, again. So, but that just even having that gives us a lot more capacity.
Right, okay. Now, what happens to the cost? I know cost is a big problem that we're all groping with. We have no real clue what's going on. It was 3 point something million Monday night, and now it's 4 point something million tonight. Will we get a new number in January?
For instance, I asked...
Or we're not going to see any numbers until the bid.
You won't see any new numbers till the bid.
Okay. Because
we've actually made the application to the SRF program at 4.2 million.
Can you give me a sense of how it would affect costs to only put in one pipe versus two?
We can't function during the summer with just one pipe. We need two pipes. Plus, okay. If I only have one pipe, I'll never have the ability to clean it.
Okay.
I'd have to put up, tell everybody at the beach to go home.
Change my question then. Tell me, how would you estimate the effect of the cost would be if we went with 3 pipes?
Add another mill.
1 million.
And I asked the question, what if we go up to, let's say, an 18-inch pipe? It's another 300,000.
Probably better going off with a third pipe, I would imagine, if we were going to go that way.
No.
Yeah, but here's
rather
the thing.
Rather than 300,000.
You don't need, in the life cycle of this, out 20 years, when the pipe size is maxed out, the Church Street pump station was designed that you put in bigger pipe pumps. It's like a same size garden hose with just a lot more pressure behind it. Because right now the upper limitation is would be the pumps themselves.
Right.
Matter of fact, they're recommending that for $2,000 I put new impellers inside my pumps to boost it up a little bit.
So you're saying a third pipe wouldn't be practical because you really don't have the pumping station capacity for a third pipe. Essentially,
right.
There.
Right.
But a third pipe as a contingency probably isn't just a lot of money sitting around on the ground,
It would not be a wise investment.
I'm just curious because for many decades, this town ran with one pipe, right? And then development on the beach increased, the demand increased.
1940s, one pipe.
Yeah.
1987, 2 pipes.
Right, so it took a long time to get to 2 pipes. But that went because of the development on the beach. Yeah. And we've had extensive development taking place on the beach, which has been increasing the demand on those pipes. And I don't know if anyone actually has a horizon in the future about when that development on the beach is going to stabilize. So I'm concerned about long-term capacity.
Right now, our max capacity is 3,000 gallons a minute.
Yeah.
With the 2 pipes and the pumps working full-time, it goes to 8,000 gallons a minute. In other words, a lot more people have to be down there all flushing at the same time for you to max that out.
Basically double or more.
Even triple.
Mm-hmm.
And we didn't I think it's very important to note, this isn't, we're not being short-sighted. There is room for growth because you'd be foolish to invest all this money to say what would happen. So it's very much to your point, you know, making sure that there is room for growth at the beach.
Which is very much a concern for me. Just so you know, I'm looking at a way to say this makes good sense to do. Right? And from what I can see, it does. But, you know, that estimation of what that risk is the big nut in my head that I can't answer and you can't answer and I'm not going to ask you about it.
Somebody else paraphrased it the other night at the selectmen's meeting. It wasn't me. And they said, this is the kind of risk that you have. If we were to have a kind of spill that would, let's say, during the summer, shut things down and maybe even make the beach water unhealthy.
Mm-hmm.
Right now you have a reputation as one of the 5 best beaches the country. It's a 5-star beach. It's a destination.
I'm aware of that, but it's an unquantifiable thing.
And they said, you know, it would take in excess of 10 years if you had a incident, 10 years to get that back. What would that affect? Would affect, I would think, property values. It would affect the tax rate. It would affect, it would have a huge ripple effect. That, and you're right, it's beyond me as to quantify what.
Not all questions have answers, right?
I would agree.
Yeah. But as I said, I'm looking at this in a favorable light.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a little uncomfortable because there are questions I want answered that can't be answered. So I'm a little uncomfortable on that level, but I was a little shocked at that extra $1 million you came in with tonight.
I was shocked when I heard it yesterday.
So we're sharing shocks.
Actually, the price, the fluctuation that I was hearing was $3 to $7 million. So I wasn't really a shock, I would say. I think, unless anyone has any more questions, I think this helps a lot.
Mm-hmm.
To have this discussion, we have a little more time than the selectmen had at their meeting. Do you think this helps a little, Regina?
I think so, yes. I think so a lot.
Have a chance to really dig it out, and everybody's thinking of something different,
mm-hmm.
which is good. Thank you for what you're doing on that. Now we're going to, and we will make a decision when we do our final review. But that helps a lot, and if you get bid prices in, set up and down or holler at us or something, and we'll be interested. The next article for you is the Lafayette Road Sewer. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $1,100,000 for the purpose of replacing the sewer main in Lafayette Road from its intersection with High Street to the intersection of Toll Avenue and Winneconnet Road? The current main is composed of vitrified clay pipes 10 and 12 inches in size that were installed in 1934 and 1982 and are in failing condition. Various pieces are missing from the pipe, making it impossible to properly clean and inspect the pipe or to reline the pipe. Therefore, replacement is necessary before complete failure occurs. In the course of replacement, it will be necessary to excavate the eastern side of the highway that will require partial reconstruction of the roadway and patching and repairs. To provide a uniform roadway, it will be necessary to reconstruct the entire roadway, as explained in a companion warrant article, and such sum to be raised by the issuance of municipal bonds or notes for a period not to exceed 30 years, under and in accordance with the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen and the Town Treasurer to issue and negotiate such bonds or notes, and to determine the rate of interest thereon, in accordance with the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for, contract for, accept, and expend any federal, state, or other available funds towards the project, in accordance with the terms and conditions under which they are received, and to borrow in anticipation of the receipt of such funds and or the issuance of such bonds or notes as provided in the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, and to authorize participation in the State Revolving Fund, RSA 486:14, established for the purpose, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for, accept, and expend such monies as they become available from the federal and state governments, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to implement such cost-effective solutions as are presented in the future that they deem to be in the best interests of the town that may result in a lesser amount of expenditure than is authorized by this warrant article, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to take any and all actions necessary to carry out the project in the best interests of the town of Hampton, 3/5 vote necessary. Fred, what do you have an equal hope that this can come under SRF as you do the drainage?
Yes.
You think that's a reasonable expectation?
Yeah, because of the imminent danger of the collapse and failure of the pipe.
Right.
We've already had a major overspill in that pipe because of this condition.
Okay. Now, I have a question to start off. If I heard you correctly, when you were in with the selectmen Monday night, I understand absolutely that this line has to be replaced. But you got to the Road Capital Reserve Fund, you mentioned something to the effect that you not only need to replace pipe on Lafayette Road, you need to do something with the drainage. Help me help me out, because I can't see ripping up the road, putting the pipe in, which you have to do, mm-hmm. and then a couple of years down the road, ripping it up again?
No.
Can you not combine the projects? Well, I thought I'd ask.
Yeah, but not at not everything at the same time. A number of things are in play. The experienced Hampton group has come forth and said, this is the this section of town from essentially LeMays south to the Galley Hatch, right. and even the CVS should be beautified, improved. They actually approached and said they'd like to have all nice lanterns, better sidewalks, take a look at the curbing. We've also been approached about doing something about the High Street parking lot and its lack of drainage. Mm-hmm. That was a 1950s construction, and there isn't one catch basin that serves that massive parking. So we've had our engineers look at it. They're, when they came up with this $1.1 million for the sewer, said, okay, we've got other people stepping in that want to do this, 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 and this. Mm-hmm. At the same time, Aquarian calls and says, hey, I hear you're getting ready to do something on Lafayette Road with the sewer. Mm-hmm. Can we follow you with the water?
Good.
Yeah, sure. So a game plan has been kind of hashed out. Everybody's trying to get their piece. Water company would come down one side, rip up the pavement. Absolutely. We'd come up the other side, rip up the pavement. There wouldn't be much pavement left, to be honest with you. In some instances, the water and the sewer are less than 10 feet apart. We would make them more than 10 feet apart as part of the new layout. So while we were in there, the thought was, and I think there'd been some under the previous director stating that when Exeter Row, we started at the outer section, did that mile and a half, then we did the mile and a half into town, mm-hmm. jumped the bridge. Wouldn't it be nice to do the next mile and a half south, or from LeMays all yes. the way past the Galley Hatch? Lo and behold, our engineers come to us and say, well, if you wanted to do curb backside of sidewalk to sidewalk, new lighting, get it $1.5 million. I'm like, oh, okay. Well, the fund that you championed, the Capital Reserve Fund, sure. and you always thought that there should be a sizable,
and don't let me put,
sizable project.
Yes.
I was like, well, isn't that interesting? If you keep at the, it's already at 1 point, with this year's contribution to be at 1.2, if it gets voted again in March of 17, it would be 1.5 available after I've already taking care of the, or somebody else is taking care of the sewer. Water. We've water. Taken care of the sewer. Yep. The gas company has said, yeah, we've got some things in there we'd like to straighten right. out too. There wouldn't be anything left of the pavement. Instead of just resurfacing it, why not do basically what they call a complete streets, which is, I've got numerous sidewalk complaints, just in Morelli's area, and Greg's Pizza area, and down in front of the 401 area. I've got a crosswalk there that
you walk head into a pole.
You're walking into a pole. Yeah. So there's a number of things that need to be addressed. Why not do them after? So that's kind of the project I've identified, but it really is up to the Board of Selectmen to, as you remember from the Capital Reserve Fund, for them to actually say what project that money's going to be allocated to.
I was just wondering if it was logical to try to put the two of them together. Take the money from the fund and this and get the whole thing done.
But not at the same time.
But you don't have to, but the road, you got to do the gas, the water, and the right. sewer.
We got to let the, we got to have a season to do the utility work.
Yeah.
And then a season to do the, and then the other thing comes to question, how do you do that and still maintain vibrant businesses mm-hmm. and traffic flow?
Now, Chris, the line that goes through Morelli Park, Morelli Square,
mm-hmm.
water or sewer? It goes out to the railroad track.
That's drainage.
Drainage.
That's what we did last year. That was the drainage project we did.
Okay, down. So that so that part is set. Yeah. Okay, I appreciate that. Hands, questions? Mr. Pierce.
Yes, I'm a little confused about what part of the road you're going to do, because it says Sewer Main and Lafayette Road in its intersection with High Street to the intersection of Toll Avenue. I'm a little confused. Toll Avenue is parallel.
Yeah,
Lafayette.
We actually turn left. Oh, excuse me. Turn left off of Lafayette, and that's the same really bad section of clay pipe, and take go down a portion of Winnicunnet till we get to the intersection of Toll.
Oh, so that's you're going about a block of that then.
Yeah.
Okay. And another question I have, which being these are both your Warnockles, how can it be no cost at the bottom of the page from both of these projects? It looks like it would cost more than something.
Well, because at the time, I believe these were drafted, and Christy or Fred can back me up on this, you didn't have a current valuation, therefore they don't figure that out till.
Okay, so we don't know what the tax rate will be at this point.
That's beyond my job description.
Thank you. That's all I have for right now.
Yep.
Mr. Jones?
Chris, I was listening to the Warren Articles discussion on money that's supposed to separate me. And I thought I heard them say that cameras have been put down this in the past.
1989 was when the first problem was discovered. We don't put the camera down in the area between 401 down to that defunct gas station on the corner. We fear that we'd lose the camera in that section. Mm. Some of the sections of pipe are missing.
I thought I heard them say that they had identified a problem long before 87.
To my knowledge, it was in 89.
And in 87, they decided to put in cameras, or they put in cameras a second time, or?
Yeah, well they cleaned it.
Yeah.
And then when they put the camera in after they cleaned it, they realized that the pressure, the 2,000 PSI pressure generated by the cleaning head, it actually opened up some of the sections of pipe. So the decision was made, unless really necessary,
you can't put a camera down because it's not sufficiently clean.
Right. Because we had an overflow in that section of pipe this past spring. Let's see, February was the force main.
After the force main.
Yeah, it was. We got that done March, so it would have been like the last week of March, first week of April. I can look up one of my notes. I got a call, hey, sewer manhole's missing. A plug of grease had literally lifted the manhole up and floated it down the street.
So I thought I heard one of the selectmen say they put a camera down and they saw no change.
Well, we did not. When we cleaned that up, we went up the pipe a little bit. We went down the pipe a little bit. When we realized we had the majority of the pipe cleaned and things were back to flowing, we didn't go any further.
That was in 87, all that.
No, this is this past April.
I think the comment, and I could be completely wrong, from the selectman meeting of nothing had changed, was more relevant to there was some issues in 1989, and we're here in 2017, and it didn't fix itself. Like, nothing has changed. It didn't get better.
Right. What might raise the question in my mind, does that mean it didn't get worse? What indication do we have that it's gotten worse?
Right, we because I haven't put the camera down, no one's put the camera down.
Is there any reason to believe that it's gotten worse?
I think if you saw those pictures, you'd say yes.
I mean, there's sections of pipe.
If I saw those pictures, I'd be asking myself, how could it be functioning at all, right?
Well, because if you pick, I said the same thing, because I said, well, if there's a hole in the bottom of the pipe, wait, we have a problem. A lot of these pictures, the fissures or the cracks that you see, they're radial at the top of the pipe. So unless this pipe is flowing full, which it doesn't do all the time or hardly ever, you wouldn't know that. He's bringing you a picture now. There's actually a section of pipe missing from the top. Cracked. So it's the same scenario.
And you have where the cracks are, you have
seepage. Yeah, the water's still flowing with that missing.
Sadie, I'm sorry.
Where the cracks are, you have seepage of groundwater.
You certainly can, and that's infiltration, and that goes to our system, and then we wind up treating it.
So that's my overall question. If you put a camera down there, it looks ugly, but yet the water flows. So is there really a problem?
There's definitely a problem. Sure. Sewer pipes need to be
whole. The problem, it looks ugly, but no one looks down there.
Well,
it's not so much aesthetics.
I have some metal drain pipes, the same thing. The bottom's eaten out due to acid rain. The water still flows on the ground. Probably still flows here on the ground.
Yeah.
Mr. LeBranche?
It's been for 30 years, right? Mm-hmm. This condition.
But the same terms that Ms. Barnes read in the AO basically apply to this. In other words, if you know that you have a defect, you need to address it.
Mm-hmm. Well, we've known it for 30 years. And well, they haven't gone after
takes
us.
Takes a little time.
We wound up having yet another overflow, and I think that that's the important part to note, is that in time, obviously something has changed, because we had an overflow this past spring where something did get blown.
Was it during heavy rains?
No, it was a nice sunny day.
This was the grease thing. Yeah.
Okay, Mr. LaBranche has a question.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thanks.
Yeah, I'm so curious. When you talk about various pieces are missing from the pipe, so that's a mystery to me. So it still flows, but the pipe, there's no pipe there. What is there?
Top sections and side sections are missing.
So it's a clay pipe. It's an old clay type of pipe. So picture a piece of a flower pot missing, you know, type on the inside.
Still holds the flower.
But still holds the flower. The soil stays sort of in the flower pot.
Okay, so again, talk about lakes, water infiltration, and could collapse any minute, actually.
Oh, maybe we need to plant flowers, right?
Well,
that's quite a situation, I've got to say.
You packed the soil down so hard, you've actually made another pipe on the outside, and that's why it's still flowing.
But that makes it a good thing, doesn't it?
No.
Why not? It works.
Until you breach that and the road collapses.
Yeah,
exactly. A heavy enough truck goes over it, and at some point,
right. Been that way for 30 years.
Okay. You have contamination, too, if you have pipes broken.
Well, yeah, I mean, annually we treat 900 to 950 million gallons of effluent a year. Mm-hmm. Aquarian only sells the town somewhere around 320 to 350 million gallons. Yeah.
You get a lot of seepage.
That's 60% of the water that I'm treating at the plant is actually groundwater.
Right. And that was one of the reasons for the beach infrastructure project, to get rid of all the infiltration. No,
and it did. It got, the beach project got rid of a million
and then
gallons
Mr. Pierce.
A day.
Yeah.
Sitting here wondering where going back 30, 40 years, how come nothing ever got done?
Because you're in Hampton, Sonny.
Oh.
It's called kicking the
I've been to the capital improvement.
Next year.
Well. Yeah, no, they just.
Mr. Pearson?
Yes, you said something about the grease. Don't we do grease inspections at all the restaurants?
Mm-hmm. Grease trap.
So how do we get that much grease in the sewage then?
A lot of it comes out of the residential neighborhoods.
Oh, so I can blame all these people at the table for that problem.
Not really. These are nice people.
I don't live on Lafayette.
I don't live on Lafayette. Okay. All right. Any further?
Yes.
Wow. That's a two-hand request.
Sometimes it will require three, no doubt. Chris. I'm looking at the warrant articles as I see so far, and I see the most important of all warrant articles out there is the now $4 million sewer lines from the beach to the wastewater treatment plant. Right? And when I look at the Lafayette Road sewer, I see, you know, he just added $1 million to the most important one of all, and this one is $1 million, basically. And it's still working. It seems. Yeah, there's a risk that it might stop at any time. I could say the same thing about the pipe coming out of the beach. But that happens as well, what if, you know, that actually risk is realized. And it's pretty serious stuff out there. But here, I don't see the same degree of seriousness.
Well,
tell me why I'm wrong.
It's not a... you're not wrong.
Okay, thank you very much.
No, I think we need to add that because the people upstream would feel as important of their businesses and their homes that are upstream of this line.
The town's arteries are its water lines and its sewer lines.
Every person in Hampton is of equal worth to me. I'm only trying to estimate the impact on the town as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
The impact of the town as a whole, if that happens down at the beach, is pretty enormous.
But realize, in this
Lafayette
Road line...
But on that little section
line,
Lafayette Road, I don't see the same enormity.
Yes.
Everything north of that location
is coming down through that. Uh-huh. Everything from LeMay's, you know, everything from the 401, which, and that's just below there is where this physical problem is.
Yeah.
Everything north of there relies on this particular section.
Yeah.
When it kind of comes down.
How confident are you with this $1.1 million number right here?
I am very confident on that one because it's a replacement in location.
You're confident? That's all I wanted to know. Thank you very much.
But these are arteries. And you know,
I want to find a way to improve it,
yeah.
to approve it for my own vote. And you're giving me sufficient argument to say, I'll take a look at something that I don't think is not working. But you're giving me sufficient argument to take a look at it. We're not taking a vote tonight, so I don't have to make a decision tonight. But thank you for your direct answers, Chris.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Okay, I think we are pretty well set. A good discussion, though.
Madam Chair, do I suggest that we can skip over all that financial stuff?
Yes.
When you read the subsequent ones?
The SRF funding would apply to this as well. Now, what financial thing are we skipping over?
Where the zeros are.
Yeah. The two first, in this case, the first two paragraphs is all it needs. Yeah.
And then leave off the rest of
it. I need to read all that.
All right.
Because they're all the same on all of them.
Now, well, no, not really.
And they're all free.
All the financial legal leases.
Well, there's no SRF in this one, et cetera. But the next article is to replace the Bicentennial Park seawall. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $2 million for the purpose of replacing the seawall at Bicentennial Park? Such sum to be raised by the issuance of municipal bonds or notes for a period not to exceed 30 years, under and in accordance with the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen and the Town Treasurer to issue and negotiate such bonds or notes, and to determine the rate of interest thereon in accordance with the Municipal Finance Act. Do you want to stop?
That's right. Yes, that's excellent. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Now, Chris, I've had some calls because people were watching the meeting on Monday. Has anyone explored the possibility of the Coast Guard or state or whatever having some responsibility for that area, not just the town? If you look back historically, because I think that's where the old Coast Guard station was, isn't it?
It was.
Yeah. And so I've had questions regarding that, and I thought I would check. Are there other people who can share the pain?
This is mine. This is hers, probably.
This is mine. As far as sharing the pain, I mean, it's not... The problems with the seawall stem from years of design and development of how one constructs a seawall.
Mm-hmm.
As I explained at the meeting on Monday, right now what you have is you had an existing wall. I mean, at one point you had the Coast Guard station there. They had the ramps down.
Mm-hmm.
There's an existing wall. Later on, a wall sort of got formed over it mm-hmm. to increase its height and develop the area. You have what they call a silica reaction. I'm missing a word there. That's happening on the internal concrete wall, right. Which causes it to expand. And it's something that has happened to concrete structures all over. This is not... here just in Hampton. I mean, this is a reaction that happens in concrete based on aggregate mm-hmm. that was put in the chemicals when it was built. So sharing the responsibility, have I personally seen if we could find anybody else whose fault it is that the wall is falling down?
Yeah.
No. What we've done is determined what's wrong with the wall, what can be done to stabilize it, what needs to be done to repair/replace it.
But what about the ownership of the land? I mean, the Coast Guard or the government owned the Coast Guard station, and did they build that on town land, or was that considered federal land?
Those things I don't know, but I'm pretty sure we own it now.
Federal land until they signed it over to the town. And
you think?
Once they sign it over to the town, the environmental hazards that go with it are then the responsibility of the person.
So you think it was signed over, Fred?
We own it.
We bought it or whatever.
Because the town burned down the Coast Guard station after that.
Okay. Well, I just... Yeah, no, we definitely own it, and I was going to say it's sort of like a car, you know, shy of...
Other questions? Mr. Pierce.
You said the town burned down the Coast Guard station. What year was that?
Fred remembers, I don't know.
I can't tell you. Okay.
It was 19...
Late
67, I believe, 65 probably. In there.
Because it was here when we moved in.
Yeah, it was in the 60s.
It was here when I first...
There is a nice article on the Hampton Library website. I did a lot of my historical research right there.
Oh, isn't that good? Very nice.
Just so you know.
Can you briefly describe what you're going to do with the seawall? Because it looks like most of it, after you get by the first two sections going north, look like you're still in place, so to speak.
Right.
The first two are the ones that are kind of funky.
Right. So to understand the seawall in its entirety, the study that was appropriated at last March meeting involved doing borings into the soils itself and corings of the wall itself, and not just the broken sections you saw, but the whole length of the wall. Mm. That wall is not sitting or attached to anything solid. Oh. Some of the actually footing or the depth of the concrete below the sand, in some cases, is only 2 feet. So it's not just about the broken, like the concrete part, but also stability. So you'll notice if you haven't been down there today, I mean, we're down there. It is now marked no trespassing. We do not want people... in around the world until we can finish.
We have a couple of ocean swells that might carry it out.
Yeah.
To see
you. You know, I've got Christmas coming, a few other things. I'd prefer that didn't happen. Yeah. We're not getting snow this year. I got a memo. So, I mean, it's one of those things. We'll leave that off. But we're being prepared. We're being precautionary. There's going to be, you know, an idea to keep it safe, an idea to stabilize, and then what we need to do, which is this Warren article. Improve it.
How firm is the price?
Okay, this is mine, right?
Yeah.
It's not. and I say that because this study was, we got the results of this study the Friday before Thanksgiving. So the engineer came down, had all the borings done, all the testing came back. We posted a memo, we sent it out to the selectmen and everything. So they are diligently working through alternatives so we can present them.
Okay. Mr. Jones.
Will you have a firm number for January 12th public hearing?
January 12th, firm number?
We're supposed
like
to.
Like a bid number or design?
No, an engineer's cost estimate we are supposed to have for a solution, but not a bid number, no.
This number of $2 million is supposed to actually fix the wall, right?
Right.
Yes.
For how long?
It is the repair. It's for the equivalent. When I say new wall, there's options that are being presented. A new wall or some repair. Combination thereof using existing and proposed.
But if it was a new wall.
Okay, gentlemen, remember the hands? Okay, Mr. Ladd, and then Mr. LaBranche, and then Mr. Kravitz. Mr. Ladd.
What do you get, one question?
Oh. Are you still questioning?
Yes.
That's not like you.
Thank you, Bob. Now, the $2 million you're asking for, what's that going to do? What's that proposed to actually do? To fix the wall, right?
Correct.
But you don't know
and
what kind of fix it is.
And the engineering and the design. Yes. There are multiple...
I don't think this plan is ready to fly yet.
Right. You know, no, and that's what I'm saying. There are three alternatives that we're looking at
right. That
will have three different price tags. This was the average price of those three alternatives. So that's why the answer to the original question is
I think maybe
no,
another year
concrete.
To get this thing fully thought out.
Probably. And, it'll certainly take a year to permit, which is part of the issue.
Right.
Yeah.
And you don't need any more money to do that, do you?
We don't have any.
We don't have any money to engineering.
We do not have a design or an engineering budget for this project at all.
So
it would come out of that.
So what would the design be?
Up to 10% of the
100,000.
It's probably a $200,000.
Well, why don't we reconsider this Warren article for just the design side? That's just a suggestion. I'm not likely to support this as it is. I would consider, as I did last year, you know, looking into it.
Yeah.
One final question. How long has the wall been in place? Have you done your research now?
Since the 60s.
50 years.
The second wall, yeah.
Okay, thanks. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Okay, Bob?
Just a question on sea level rise. Will that be taken into account when you replace this wall?
The design, the analysis that they've done is taken into account the sea level rise.
And will the wall be designed in a way that it could be raised at a future point in time?
Well, it could always be capped and recapped, if you will, and brought up higher, yes. Yeah. See, one of the things that they would do under this design is actually drive sheathing or steel piles down into the ledge. The ledge is some, on average, 16 to 20 feet below this. And the rest of the seawall down the beach is already secured to the ledge. This section is not. So if a strong storm underpins the seawall, it'll just settle.
Yeah. Okay, Mr. LaBranche?
I've been down there, but I just want to try to visualize what we're talking about. I know that the state just finished their wall, and their wall goes just a little bit north of where the bathhouse is.
Right.
Yeah. And then you have a parking lot, and that's where our wall starts.
Exactly. Correct.
How many feet does that go? How many?
300
feet of concrete. And after that, it becomes rocks, and then it
rocks,
big
right.
rocks.
Yeah. Right.
And then it's... Then it
fish houses, it gets
fish
higher.
Houses and, right,
right. Yeah.
Now, I can understand why we have a wall from Boar's Head up to a little bit north of the bathhouse, because we actually have a road there. But we have, where this wall is a parking lot, correct? So we're protecting a parking lot. The point I'm making is, do we need a wall there at all?
Yes.
Could we take the wall? No, I'm just asking.
Yeah.
Could the wall not be there and just have big rocks that would be... Because that's as you go up further into Place Cove, that's what you have, rocks. And then you have a beach with just sand.
You've observed before where we have an ocean storm and it literally you get what they call the tidal surge where
yes,
under
I have
the wind effect
that.
It pushes it into the harbor.
Yeah,
well, imagine that same wind pushing an extra 2 feet of water down the seawall, the state seawall. Gets to ours, and ours is 2 feet lower, make an immediate left. We've already got photos of it, the storms or the regular tides that we get now, channeling some of that sand across onto Route 1A and then down onto Winnicunnet.
Yeah, I guess, so. but the point, at some point, after 300 feet, there is no wall.
Right.
Okay, so what you just said
their
could
design,
in effect happen.
Right, their as design you go north is going to have to. We discussed that with them on Friday. You're going to have to give us something additional at that location. In other words, we go out right now. Frank will be out if not within the week, within 2 weeks. We put in a couple of Jersey barriers, and then we bury it. Those Jersey barriers with 2 foot plus boulders. In an effort to keep that water from surging down through there. One of the reasons why we hired this firm is they had experience in other locations of actually then installing temporary gates or some sort of barricade. So you're right, so that doesn't become the weak point.
Yeah. Well,
there's no sense in pushing it the problem 310 feet down the beach and then not taking care of it.
Well, the reason that I've lived at the beach now for, and I live right on Ocean Boulevard, and I've lived in this town now for 25 years. And I've seen plenty of surge. I don't know if you know where I live, but just a little south of Boar's Head. And, once you get a little further beyond that wall, and the rest of it as you go up the coast, there is no wall. I don't remember, I think there was some flooding one time in the Place Cove area where the ocean water actually get into the roads, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
So that was because of a surge. But that would happen anyway, because there's no wall right. Once you get past that point. I just wonder where you decide to not have the wall. And if you have a wall that's going 300 feet, why does it only go 300? Because at one point there was a ramp, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So that's where it stopped.
Right.
What if it only went 200 feet?
It could. Yeah.
That's all I'm saying. Or even 100 feet. Does it need to be the full 300 feet? Could it be put back to the way it more natural type of thing? And just make sure that you have dunes and rocks and things that are going to hold back that.
You got no place for dunes.
Yeah, dunes get washed.
Well, he doesn't have a design yet. He's already said that.
Okay. So. I'm just throwing an eye. I'm just asking some questions. Thank you very much.
Sunny
I'm just
is
asking.
Next. Yeah. And I haven't forgotten you, David.
I've been listening to the amateur engineers all night. It occurs to me.
Oh, my goodness.
Why not put pile drive interlocking steel beams, go down as deep as you want, about 8 feet, 8 inches from the wall, and backfill with rebar and cement and make it.
Because in 20 years, when it rusts, they're going to be saying, why did they put. Because in 20 years, when it rusts and decays, they're going to be saying, I mean, that's what the state did with their beach. Well, but after 37, they put in the sheet piles. And then years later, they came in and put a metal concrete cap on the sheet piles. Then years later, they came in and entombed it. Then years later, they came back in now and sand water blasted off the top and raised it a couple feet.
The water would keep it.
All you're doing, Sonny, is we're trying to move towards a more permanent fix. Sustainability is a word that's thrown around a lot in the engineering community. And I, for one, embrace it to the point, for instance, I don't like asphalt curb because I keep plowing it up. I like granite curb because it's resilient. It stays there. Salt's impervious to salt. I wouldn't have put a force main under a marsh because it's not sustainable. There could be a $1 temporary fix to this problem, but then it'll be a $2 temporary fix the following year. And my point is, I don't want people coming back and going, what were you thinking? And because that's what we're asking now of people that put things in under the marsh in 1962. Long term, what were you thinking?
I have Dave and then Mike.
My question was, you were talking one time about replacing the entire wall. That was one of the three items.
Mm-hmm.
And my question was, if you went that option, and you may not have the answers yet, so this may be a premature question, I apologize. When you're looking at that, when the engineers, did they give you an estimate for the longevity of that wall? 20 years, 40 years, or a 68 wall versus, am I making sense with my question?
Their analysis went out 50 years.
50 years.
They were looking, and more from the perspective of sea rise and climate change and things of that nature. And that, they've been actually using wave analysis data obtained 35 miles out, which is partially what they used to determine the size of the storm. And they were using a 35-foot swell 35 miles out. Because there's actually record data for that.
So with that 50 years, or whatever the time period is, I'm going to cheat with this question, because I know everything requires maintenance, but it's like...
It's hard to hear you, David.
The structure itself will hold up. It may require minor maintenance along the way.
Right.
But it will, major-wise, it's going to hold 50 years.
Yes, exactly.
Thank you.
Okay, Michael?
Yes. Now, you say that we're just sitting on the sand on our part of the seawall then. Now, what did you say? The state took their piling all the way down to
the ledge.
Bedrock.
And how did they make sure it was attached to the bedrock, so other than just being driven into sand?
They pounded in literally 5 feet.
Into the bedrock. So when you're looking at this section with your different approaches, are you going to consider doing that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's the only thing that was... If we literally took the... You know, be like... Take a popsicle stick or a straw and put it in a soda drink or even a milkshake, a thickened milkshake, you can still move the straw.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't drive it through the bottom of the cup into something more, you're always going to be able to move that, and that would be the same thing.
Right. Okay. There's the sheet piling, and it's also, remember I was saying it's not just the cosmetics, it's the stability this way.
Right.
You know, there's nothing, you know, there's nothing holding the wall down on this side either except for the sand. So you realistically, if you weren't going to pound something 10 to 12 feet down into the rock, you could build almost like a slab, you know, something that counter exit on this side. And those are the things that they're looking at, and they're looking at them for cost. They're looking at them for maintenance, looking at them for longevity. I mean, that's part of the exercise to get to a design plan.
Ryan's next.
What would it cost just to fix what's broken? And the two sections that you mentioned are about ready to flip over?
Zero. Because, Brian, the problem is the wall's too low.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I can go parge it tomorrow with Quikrete, put a coat of paint on it, but it's like putting lipstick on, you know what. So.
Yes.
Gotcha. It's, it give you a warm feeling, but it's
yeah. Very, I just curious.
That's an area that takes a tremendous amount of damage anyway. Mm-hmm. But having served with the Conservation Commission, and I've been on site walks up there, the Planning Board has been encouraging the neighbors who own property north of that, are encouraging them to build bigger, fatter, higher, more substantial walls mm-hmm. in front of the property. Because those places take a terrible beating.
Yep.
Are we all set on yes. this warrant article?
Yes.
All right.
First paragraph only, please.
Well, Mary Louise, there might be something you want to read in this one toward the bottom.
Well, I was trying to read the whole thing so everybody right. knew, but whatever. you mean the fiscal impact or?
No, article is
final figures will be available.
No, the next, we're doing the next one, right?
Well, I'm not on the next one. If you want me to read the bottom line on the one that we're
No.
Talking about the next one. All
yes.
of the
bottom line of the next slide.
No.
First paragraph and last paragraph.
No, not the last paragraph. It's in the middle, Mary Louise.
Oh.
This article is contingent upon the approval.
Oh, of TAP funds.
Right, so that should be something that's known.
Okay.
TAP funds.
I will do my best. Try not to fall asleep.
TAP money. They don't raise it.
Street and sidewalk improvements, Winnicott Road and High Street. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $1 million?
Gotcha.
Huh? Such appropriation to be offset by the reimbursement from the Transportation Alternatives Program funding, estimated at $800,000, for the purpose of constructing street improvements along Winnicott Road, including the creation of new sidewalks on both the north and south side, pedestrian crossings, traffic calming techniques, landscaping and new signage from the Center School to Mill Road, and the construction of a new sidewalk along the north side of High Street between Toby Avenue, should be Toby Street, and Five Corners, where there currently is none, as recommended by the Safe Routes to School Plan, to provide a choice for non-motorized users that is safe, reliable, and convenient, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for, etc. And it says this article is contingent upon the approval of the TAP funding.
I think you can read the last paragraph as well. No, the transportation.
Well, you know, I could have read the whole confounded thing.
No, but the last paragraph is important too.
So read it, Steve.
The Transportation Alternative Program funding is a reimbursement. The project total is estimated to be $1 million, and after reimbursement, it is expected that the total cost of the project will be $200,000. This is basically the Safe Routes to School
mm-hmm.
plan
mm-hmm.
to enhance and make walking safer for the youngsters as they're trying to go to school to the Marston and the junior high and center school. All right. The sum of $1 million. How firm is that? Anybody know? By the way, I think
firm.
Are we set?
That's all I can get.
We still need you. Okay. How firm is that figure?
It is firm to the extent. Firm is relative here. To do this application, you have to understand the process. So I think it's probably important that you understand how this warrant article is developed. The school system did the Safer School Plan. Mm-hmm. Safer School Plan identified areas throughout town that could use improvement, gave suggestions, did preliminary cost estimating. We have been working with the school to identify these areas, look at what they're doing, look at our master plan for sidewalk. I know on Tuesday,
The question came up, did we have any money in our budget for sidewalks? The answer was yes, we had a budget line. You also asked if we had warrant articles for sidewalks. Last year, we had the warrant article for $42,000 plus the $26,000 in the budget, and we were able to do High Street. If you look at the capital improvement plan, it's a continuation of High Street all the way down to make it ADA accessible and wide enough to make them usable routes. So using that in conjunction with the Safe Routes to School and identifying this area and the preliminary costs, that $1 million identifies the improvements in this corridor from Center School to Winnicunnet Road. It is a cost estimate. It is not bid. The design drawings are not done. That is part of this grant. Part of this grant is doing your design, doing your survey, doing... So that money is in this.
Okay. And correct, if you will, make sure it says Toby Street instead of Toby Avenue. The school, and we went through this discussion earlier this year, the school has no authority to construct anything on town land. So the school is helping to implement the safe routes for their youngsters by applying for grants and helping with grants so that the town, it would be the town.
It, the town of Hampton applied for this grant, not the school board.
But the school has been pushing for it, right?
The school, I want to call it a collaborative project. Mm-hmm. We as DPW and we as the town just as much want the safe sidewalks and safe routes. So to me, it's not one or the other. It's really, they helped by doing the identification.
But we have explained that they do not need and cannot have money to construct sidewalks in the school budget. So this is, as you say, the cooperative effort between the town and the Department of and Public Works and the school district. Okay.
And the grant was judged on, and we got a very high score on it, on the basis that, one, we were following as a follow-up to the Safe Routes to School initial round of funding, and secondly, that it was a cooperative project supported by the school board.
Right.
And was in keeping with the town's master plan and traffic enhancement and all those other things. So having their name attached to it was extremely beneficial. Matter of fact, if it was not attached to it, we'd have been at the bottom of the pool.
Yeah. Okay. So, Sonny?
Yeah. As I read this, what I'm missing is bike paths.
Oh.
Bicycle paths.
Looking at bicycle paths is part of this. That's part of the grant money. That's what they judge it on. And we'll know, they're supposed to tell us by December, so this month.
Because if you look at Portsmouth, you can see what they've done. Mm-hmm. I was in New York recently, and it's more dangerous to cross a bike path than to the street. So, you know, I think that should be part of,
and that's one of the
part of the policy of the town. So
it has to be addressed. Yeah.
Further questions, Mr. Jones?
I am inclined to support this. I mean, it's excellent funding when you think about it. It's $1 million. We have to only put up $200,000, maybe $800,000. But I do have some concerns. There's a lot of stuff on here in terms of what you're planning on doing. Do you have to do all of this stuff in order to get the $800,000 reimbursement?
You have to expend it. You
don't have to do everything on this list.
So on this list, and let's just, so we're saying that we're going to create new sidewalks, which we would do. We would definitely have pedestrian crossings re-identified, remarked, which we would definitely do. Traffic calming techniques. I mean, that's a menu. You can pick one of these, one of that. So we're not being specific as to the measure. Landscaping and new signage, that would come with identifying school zones, traffic speeds. Landscaping would be appropriate for any green spaces that were added.
So you're saying in these areas you have all kinds of choice. You're not submitting a design to the feds.
It was not
saying, this is what we're going to do, give us the money. You're just saying, hey, we've got funding for the $200,000. We're going to do this general stuff. Give us the money.
And we give them ideas of how we would do it and how we would measure it. So
do they approve any of those ideas? Or
we'll know in December if they select our project. I mean, the reason I think it's important for everybody to understand that section in here that says the article is contingent upon the approval of TAP funding.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. $25.2 million
in projects was submitted. 5.4 is going to be awarded. So there are 46 other towns.
I love that line in there. It's a great safety net. I thank Selectman Phil Bean for inducing it to be put in there. Mm-hmm. And, of course, that makes it almost a no-brainer for me to support. But I am just concerned about, gee, we got 80% of this project done, and next year we're going to come back and ask for another $500,000 to finish the rest of it, or that kind of thing.
No.
That's where I'm coming from.
And unfortunately, it's really not how the TAP funding works either. You work within the budget that was established for the grant.
Well, it's all about management. I'm saying if you get, yeah, you know, 80% of it done and say, well, I need another $500,000 to finish the last 20%. Gee, we got all this invested. Let's do that extra $500,000. I really don't want to hear that story next year or the year
you
after.
You don't want to be the person sitting okay here telling you that story.
Excellent. That's all I have. Thank you.
Okay. I think we've pretty much beaten that one around.
I have a
the
question.
Next one is the paving highway.
I have a question before you try, John. What section of the when it kind of road are you going to do? Just this, from Lafayette Road just to Center School?
Lafayette to Mill. Mill Road.
Lafayette all the way to Mill. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Those kids are walking down from High Street.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Thank
you. Okay, David?
Quick question. When you put sidewalks in, you're talking here, I've seen two types of sidewalks in Hampton. You've got the concrete with the curves, which I know you like the curves, which I do too. Mm-hmm. But then other ones are blacktop. So what are you going to use here, and why do you use one versus the other? Why do we use both?
It's a very good question. This will come down to Mr. Jones, you know, making sure we don't run out of money. A lot of the time the decision is based on the money that's available. Yeah. The asphalt is significantly cheaper than the concrete. You can use it more when you don't need a curb. I don't necessarily like asphalt on granite curb, although we have plenty of it in town. If we can afford concrete, we'd rather go concrete.
Because it probably has a longer lifespan, is that true?
Longer lifespan, but more involved maintenance costs,
yes.
i.e. if I ever need to get into it, I have a utility crossing or I need something, now I have to jackhammer out concrete. I never can get it really to look the same again. There's definitely some weighing options. This was not submitted and determined as to which way it would be done.
It could be A or B.
Yeah. Correct.
Thank you.
And concrete requires, and I love the concrete sidewalks, but they require sealing at frequent, annual, and we haven't done that in Hampton for a long time. Okay, going on to the paving highway block grant. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $650,000 for improvements to streets consisting of paving overlays, adjustments to structures to permit paving, repairs and replacements to drainage, crack sealing, curbing installation, and improvements to the following streets: Ann's Lane, Merrill Industrial Drive, and Drakeside Road, including the paving and roadway reconstruction required with the removal of the railroad trestle abutments. Said appropriation to be offset by the State Highway Block Grant, estimated to be $307,854. This shall be a non-lapsing appropriation. I'm not sure how closely you guys have figured this, but we need to be careful when we're doing the highway, the requests. You've heard me in the past say, please put the streets that you know you can do, the streets that are high on your list. But I've had people come back, and I think it's reasonable, and say, well, those were the only streets that were showing in the warrant article, so if they have leftover money, they can't use it for anything else. Can you put in here and such other? I hated in the old times to have 12 streets that never got done. Mm-hmm. So we've tried to focus on the ones that A, you know you can pay for, right, and B, that are up on the priority list. But if you should have some money left over, right, I think it might be a good little finger in the crack to add into the wording of the warrant article that if funds are left over, the department will be authorized to go to the next street on the priority list or something.
Yes, and I would agree with you wholeheartedly. I mean, that's what allowed me to pave a portion of Heritage
right.
this year after it fell apart during the winter.
Right.
Add that wording. Good idea.
Yes.
I'd like to add a comment.
It doesn't hurt to be on the safe side.
I'd like to add a comment to that. When you don't list them like that or do what she suggested, sometimes the road gets done as strictly, has nothing to do with the condition of the road. It's only a political thing. That's the way it appears to me. And a couple of times that's happened. So I would suggest we try to be as specific as we can. And when you do have money left over, it goes to the next highest priority. Yes. With the condition of the road, not because Mike Pierce wants that one done today, okay, for example.
And we do have a pavement
I know you
list, and it's part of the CIP, and we've been following it.
Mm-hmm.
The only one that I've stuffed in, added last year that I wasn't able to do was Acorn, because I didn't realize that while we had an article that allowed us to accept it, nobody had ever deeded over the rights to it, so they couldn't really pave it legally. So that was about the only one, but that was me being excited about getting out there and doing it.
Right.
But there were frustrated residents for years when it showed the 12 streets,
right.
and year after year after year after year, their street was on it and never got done.
Like
so.
Ann's Lane is on here. But if the sewer breaks and I don't get to sleeve Ann's Lane like I have in the sewer portion, I won't be doing Ann's Lane.
Yeah.
I would consider it a poor investment of your money to pave over something that I'm not done doing the subsurface work for.
Right.
Base Road, Rock Road, et cetera, et cetera. We could go on and on. Sonny?
Yeah. I'm curious. If we get all these things done, we can coast for the next 50 years, or are you going to put stuff on a capital improvement plan?
No, when you pave a road, about 7 years after it, I'm in crack sealing it. And maybe 7 years after that, I should be in what they call putting down a microsurface, which is very thin shim coat. But it's almost, the new microsurfacing is more structural than the old stuff is. 20 years is the norm. But I know we've got roads that have been longer than 20 years. They said Landing Road, I think Mr. Tilton said, you know, it was something like he just got married or something like that.
Yes.
The last time he saw, you know, it was. But understand that each road is different because it's on different soils, and also truck traffic. Number of vehicle trips, all that matters, and so there's guidelines, but no, doing it once doesn't. It's like the sewer line; eventually, they do fail. You know, they wear out. So
And we're going to have to move a little bit because we only got till 10 o'clock, and we have a little more ground to cover.
Go to the next one.
The next one is the Road Improvement Capital Reserve Fund, and Chris mentioned it. Christy, what precisely and exactly is the total in the Capital Reserve Fund for the roads right now?
I don't have the custody report with me, but I don't know.
Oh, okay. I thought it was more than a million. I thought with what was appropriated in 2016, I thought it was about at least 13,000, but I'm not sure.
In interest, it was around 13,000.
Yeah, 130,000, should I? Well, yeah, whatever thousand it is. 1.3 million. There we go. Thank you. It's a good thing we've got you. The problem, I think, is that we haven't been adjusting this as the years have gone by, and we probably should be doing. I'm going to use Exeter Road as an example. Exeter Road was patched, and you covered it over so we weren't falling into potholes. But Exeter Road is going to have to be done with the underpinnings. Sooner or later, we're going to have to do.
It was scheduled out more than 7 years ago, out in the future.
And the idea of that trust fund and that capital reserve fund was for big projects. And my idea of a big project, for example, is Exeter Road. Now, at this rate, with the 300,000, I don't know,
but you might want to think about starting to change that to $500,000 as we go on into the future so that we can build that up, because that's what it was designed for the big stuff. The little stuff you're taking care of in the highway block grant, et cetera. So that's just a thought.
We just need to build it back up again because we had spent some in the last few years.
Well, the selectmen early on gutted that fund and for little stuff, and you really want that for the big deals for the public. Okay. Asset management for stormwater and wastewater assets. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $60,000 to assist the DPW in the development of an asset management program for stormwater and wastewater assets? Said appropriation to be offset by $60,000 in principal loan forgiveness under the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services Clean Water State Revolving Fund, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for, et cetera, et cetera. Chris, talk to us.
It's a loan forgiveness program. The SRF fund, the same one that will be borrowing the money for the Horse Main and Lafayette Road out of, they have already allocated this. I was up there today.
Excellent.
Amongst a number of us, they've allocated $2 million in $30,000 and $60,000 allotments.
Mm-hmm.
Someone asked a question earlier, maybe Mr. Pierce. Like the price, the impact, the tax impact at the bottom has been calculated. This tax impact is actually zero.
Right.
Because they're going to, and the reason why we're having to go through this is that it's a loan.
Yeah.
And loans have to be approved by the voters, but it will be a loan with 100 totally forgiven.
Yeah.
We will use this to buy a piece of software. We will also use it to buy equipment. The idea is that you call in and say my street sign's missing. We create a work order with this, and literally a number of the supervisors are going to get tablets, and when the new street sign goes up, they take a picture of it, and it automatically sends an email to me that the work's been done,
wow,
to her that it's been done, and if Fred wants to be on the list, he says it's done, and if you want an email, to send me an email when it gets fixed, you get one at wherever you happen to be at that moment. So it will keep track of cost. It'll prioritize our work. It'll keep track of potholing, sewer line repairs. It's going to help us do risk assessment and assess all these repairs.
Uh-oh, I see a hand up.
So, I mean, even the title says asset management for stormwater and wastewater assets.
Yes.
To my mind, asset management is asset management, whether it's stormwater or wastewater or not, right?
Exactly.
And you plan on using it as a broad-based asset management program, correct?
Right. Is that what I'm hearing? Why it says stormwater and wastewater? Those are the two funds at the
right, I get that part. That's how we get the money back. But how we're actually going to use it, we're going to use it as a generalized asset management.
We're going to use it, build it, make it better, all of it.
Now, the DPW is going to be using it. Fred, do you have expectations somewhere down the line of incorporating the other town assets in this software system?
Eventually, that will have to be done.
Excellent.
Yeah.
I think it's great to have an asset management program. I'm a little concerned about the funding side of it, not what's on this Warren article. You've got devices that are coming in that you're going to have to buy. It's not part of this.
Yes, it is.
This is just the software, I thought.
No.
And okay.
All of the devices are included with this.
Included.
Okay, and where does the puppy live? Is it one of the cloud-based services?
It is.
Okay, so we don't need to buy a server. It's cloud-based, and we are without fear of putting this on the cloud, huh? That's amazing. Excellent. Thank you. No more questions, Madam Chairman.
Excellent. I think we're all set. Oh, I'm Brian.
From borrowing the money, is there a tax impact because we're borrowing it?
No, we're not borrowing anything.
Well,
it's a loan. That's where I'm confused.
The left hand is paying the right hand.
So we're borrowing the money till we get repaid the loan?
No.
Mm-hmm. No.
You have to raise and appropriate.
Yes.
But we're getting the money. We're not going to have to tax people to get the 60 grand.
Right.
Because it's a loan, the statute RSA 33 says we have to get the form out,
right,
and we have to put that language in, otherwise we can't accept the money.
Right. Okay.
So you're cool. Okay, last one is the sidewalks. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $25,000 for the maintenance, repair, reconstruction, and replacement of sidewalks? This shall be a non-lapsing appropriation per RSA 32:7 Roman 6 and shall not lapse until this project is completed or by March 31st, 2018, whichever is sooner. I have to tell you that sidewalks really get me excited because we see leftovers every single year in the sidewalk line, and you've had another warrant article. You haven't spent all of that one, have you, with the matching grant?
So I watched that movie Tuesday, and we have spent it. It just has not been billed. So we finished the work about 3 weeks ago.
On the warrant article or on the...
Both of them. I have spent $67,976 and actually had a cut down on the work that we got... I sent out the bid because we didn't have enough money to get all the work we wanted done.
But for years, I see leftovers
there is
in that sidewalk line when we get the recaps.
But we're beyond that now.
What happened to Toll Avenue?
Toll Avenue has a right-of-way issue that we would have had to resolve first that would have made it look like we got nothing done.
That's
leftover money. So we went and started our High Street program while we resolved the right-of-way
issue. One of my pet peeves, that Toll Avenue sidewalk. All righty, Mr. Jones.
Sidewalks has become an important topic in the Budget Committee for me recently, as you probably noticed. Last year we talked about how do we do the whole town? We need a plan for the whole town. Okay? And I'm looking forward to seeing that plan. I haven't seen anything of that plan. And on reflection, recent reflection, thinking about the difficulty you have been getting contractors in to do the sidewalks, and doing some little reading on construction contractors, it seems to me that they probably like multi-year contracts. If we could say, hey, we want you to do the entire town, and we want you to do it in 5 years, give us a number. We're likely to get some bidders, are we not?
Just have the funding to do that.
It's just a way of how you write the contract. It might be going through something similar with that, with trying, you know, to get a piece of equipment that you tell the contractor you're going to give it to them for 5 years, and we're all steam ahead. In year one, it gets funded. Year two, it gets funded. Year three, it doesn't. Year four, it doesn't. Year five, it doesn't. Guess who's not coming back?
What if we funded all 5 years, though?
Well, no.
How could we? I don't know how we can.
You can't commit future boards of selectmen. Right. You can't pass a budget this year.
We're not talking budget. I'm talking warrant article.
Well,
doesn't matter.
You can't find one more.
If you put 5 years worth.
Okay.
Right. Bid out. Raise and appropriate a 5-year $1 million sidewalk thing, right? And say that year one we want this. In the contract would have to be written an escape clause. It also would have to have escalation factors unknown, what the cost of fuel and cement is going to be out for 30.
That would be the contractors looking for those.
Oh, well, and we would too.
Okay.
Because...
well, the point is that it would help increase the probability of getting the bidders that we've been having difficulty getting, right?
The previous TAP grant that we talked about will be more, there'll be more excitement about that.
Right, because of the size. And again, I'm talking the same thing with the sidewalks. We're funding too little to get the job done at all, it seems to me.
We did put this out. We did do an effort again with the school board to put out the original. I had about $85,000 worth in sidewalk, and the school had about $130,000. So you're talking almost $200,000+ worth of work, and we had zero bidders.
It still wasn't enough. That's my point. That's my point. But if you had the same $200,000 for 5 years or something like that, these contractors would be more attracted to it, wouldn't
it? The other way is to tie it to either water work, sewer work, or road work, because, for instance, Aquarian wanted to dig up everything Fast Eddie's to mobile. What was the mobile garage? They had to replace the sidewalk. The contractor that we used to replace our sidewalk also replaced that one.
All right. So my concern is that you're asking for $25,000 this year. Mm-hmm. You got $26,000 in your budget already. So which I really don't like, the double funding mechanism. I didn't like it last year. I still don't like it this year. I'd rather have that out of the budget and make this $50,000 or even higher. Last year you had $45,000, right? Or $42,000. Something in the 40s.
You had 46, 650 in a warrant article and 26
in the budget. 26 in the budget. Yeah.
And so, you know, did we get as much done this year as we anticipated? My sense is we did not, partly because of getting contractors.
The total value was $72,650 for the warrant article and the budget.
Yeah.
And I have $69,000 plus spent as of...
That's good.
At this rate, because, I mean, Chris mentioned that at our last meeting that you had a plan in terms of how we're going to do the whole town. And at this pace that we're setting ourselves up for, how many years before we actually finished the entire town?
50. We'll be back. It's sort of like the roadways. We'll be coming back around.
Yeah, I know, but how many times will you be coming around, is my question.
I don't actually have the whole thing with us, but for High Street, basically all the way from Marston to George, you're looking out to 2022.
Yeah.
So that's 6 years.
Mr. LeBrand.
That's not the whole town.
No, that's High Street.
I mean, I'd like to get a sense of how much money you need to get this town done in a defined amount of time. Mm-hmm. And that's what I mean by an overall town plan.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, Mr. LeBrand has a question.
And I don't. So, thank you, Madam Chair.
All right, come on.
On Tuesday, we approved, we looked at $26,000 for sidewalk and curbs. That's in your regular
budget.
Right.
Now, I understand that this warrant article, the $25,000 would have to be spent on sidewalks, mm-hmm. whereas in the budget, something might come up. So you may not. You may use that for something else.
I stood here a year ago and committed to you that if it said sidewalks, I was going to use it sidewalks. And trees would be
trees.
Well,
I guess I don't understand why it's in the budget and why it's on a warrant article. Maybe there's an explanation that I'm just getting tired.
No, I think you hit it on the nail head.
For some reason.
If you have it in the warrant article, you have to spend it on that.
Exactly.
And secondly, so that if the number kept getting bigger, future directors could get and not, you know, do sidewalks with it, and you'd be back to the same thing. But as long as I'm here, if it says trees, I'm doing trees. If it says, you know, sidewalks, I'm doing sidewalk. Paving is paving. And, you know, barring a force main breaking where I wipe out $130,000 and have to commit $50,000 in my engineering line and my...
That's what I'm talking about.
Right.
That comes out of this. That's going to come out of this budget.
And if there's a catastrophe.
Well, yes, of course. Of course, I realize that. And then, but the idea of putting this $25,000 is that it has to be done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's enough. That's
I think
enough.
That's
Thank
why
you.
The voters supported it.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. That's all I need.
Okay. I think
that's
we're set on that one. Next one is the wastewater treatment plant.
Bob had a
problem.
I'm
sorry.
I had a question, but it's not on sidewalks. If you like, I wait till. Yeah, that article's a completed.
Yeah, we're almost
we've
finished.
We've got two more, Pim. Yeah. We've got. I'm keeping an eye on this block here. Oh, this is pretty easy one. Wastewater treatment plant energy audit. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $16,060 to contract for a detailed process level energy audit of the wastewater treatment facility and pump stations? Said appropriation to be offset by $16,060. And principal loan forgiveness under the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services Clean Water State Revolving Fund, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for, et cetera. Fiscal impact is zero per thousand. This is another grant.
That would be zero. Zero impact.
Amazing that they woke up a little bit in Concord. You understand the intent, I believe. Any questions? Okay, and the very last one is the household hazardous waste collection. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $15,000 to conduct a household hazardous waste collection day during calendar year 2017, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to permit the towns of Hampton Falls and Newcastle to participate in said collection day at their own expense, and B, to apply for, accept, and expend for such purposes any funds from the state of New Hampshire, the federal government, and any private source.
Madam Chair, this is a no-brainer. I'm happy to vote on this and be done with it because it's just a no-brainer.
I do. I'd like to say something after we get done taking care of this message, this particular warrant article.
Okay, well, if you want to talk in this article, speak up.
So I would move to approve
this. Wait, calm down. Okay.
Yours is not related to this, is it?
It's not. Okay.
I move to approve this warrant article, even though it's unnumbered.
Okay, we're not doing that tonight. Yeah. Tonight we're discussing them. It's a very easy one.
Just trying to save time in the future, okay, so Madam Chair.
I will say that it does prevent pollution from having
We're done with that.
In the marsh. All right. Now we had Bob has something, a question or some such, and Mr. Pierce apparently does.
My question is any consideration being given to creating a capital reserve fund to start to prepare to address the issue of sea level rise going forward?
Bob, I can't hear you very well. To start a fund for what?
Sea level rise.
Sea level rise.
Sea level
rise. To create a capital reserve fund to start to prepare to address whatever issues sea level rise presents going forward.
No, we have not had any discussion about a capital reserve fund for that purpose. Reason being is,
nobody wants it.
The question that was asked before is the design of the seawall incorporating sea level rise. The answer is yes. For instance, the facility study that I'm doing for the wastewater treatment plant right now, looking at considering sea level rise and therefore making future plant recommendations based upon that? Yes. For instance, if we bought a new generator for the aeration blowers, would it be put up on a 4-foot lift? Yes. So project by project, as things are being identified, the resiliency and the sustainability to combat sea level rise is being built into those projects.
I was thinking a little more globally than that. Because
the entire planet.
The estimations of the potential problems going forward are so significant that to save the town, it seems there's some benefit in preparing for it on a broader scale than bit by bit. What would be your attitude towards something like that?
I'm a Yankee. I believe in buy a car, you save for it. You know, so I'm in favor of it. The hard part for me would be trying to quantify something that's out 50 years and 100 years.
Mm-hmm.
How do you come in today's dollars relate something that's going to happen when I'm 107 and 157? Because those are the two markers that they're using, 50 years out, 100 years out. Very difficult. I mean, we may be all using hovercrafts and not have to worry about any roads going underwater. I mean, you know, I don't know. So for me, it's going to be, if I had that capital reserve fund, I'd expect Madam Chair and Citizen Jones to question, how did you come up with this number that we put away every year? And what do you plan on extending it for? And those two questions, I don't have a good answer for.
The only thing I would suggest is long before the 1500-year time points, insurance and mortgages are going to create a dynamic that puts the whole town at risk.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So I think there's some merit in starting to drill down into this.
Would totally agree. Yeah. I think a reasonable thing, for instance, would be to re-examine, and I know it's being done, so I'm not speaking on it, but looking at your building codes, your planning regulations. Like, for instance, Florida, a number of those, they look at the wave direction, and you actually have to have your foundation aligned with...
Mm-hmm. With
the wave direction and have no impediments so that the waves can literally come through your garage and keep right on going.
Yeah.
So, rather than a CIP, a capital improvement, I think a lot more planning needs to be done to then out of the plan maybe quantify things like seawall gates, things of that nature, raising Babcock Road a foot or something like that.
Is there, do you plan on doing any planning?
Given that I'm busy with the Force Main, Lafayette, a solid waste study, sidewalk, no, at present I haven't.
Not at this time, but can you estimate any reasonable time in the future when you're beyond these immediate issues?
Yeah, I think maybe 3 years out, once we get the asset management software, which will allow me to actually quantify what we have, and it would also allow that would then allow me to quantify what which things elevation, because part of the asset will be everything will be signed in elevation, which things are going to be underwater. Yeah. Then I'd be able to quantify, okay, what's it going to take, for instance, to take all the sewer manholes, raise them up a foot to get them over that, and correspondingly raise the road. Then I'd be able to quantify it. Then I'd be able to have a discussion with you that we're looking at.
I have Mike next. Wait a second.
I'm on this topic.
If
if
you can start that process of planning within a 3-4-5 year period,
I think with the asset management software in place and actually adding in data, that would be starting it.
Yeah.
It would be data gathering.
There are pieces starting to come together. The planner is doing it. Very good job on this issue. Mm-hmm. You people working with them are.
Yep.
I'm just thinking it's time to look beyond the town's assets that it owns and to the totality of assets that are at risk.
Yep. Well, I agree, and I think that, like, for instance, the wastewater treatment plant is probably the most important asset that we have or you own that I manage that would be impacted by it. So definitely I'd be looking at the cost for that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Okay, Mr. Jones and then Mr. Pierce.
You know, Chris, on that topic, you and I and perhaps a few others ought to travel to Amsterdam and Venice because they're under sea level and they have been that way for hundreds of years. And we ought to examine just how in hell they managed to survive and thrive in such an environment. Thank you, Madam Chair.
All righty. Mike?
The tickets?
Yeah. Fred's going to handle that.
Okay.
He's a travel agent.
last Michael. Night before, I'm awake. I think so.
Speak up.
I have Regina pinch me once while I'm kicking. Anyway, back to the
Kinky.
On Tuesday night, we were going over the budget, and we questioned a change from part-time transfer station foreman to a using overtime for it. And if I remember correctly, you said it was a union contract issue.
Right.
And that piqued my interest, and I found this contract on my computer, and it says, additionally, it's agreed the following position and employees are specifically excluded from recognition or coverage under this agreement. All department heads, the secretary to the town manager, part-time public works transfer station foreman, mm-hmm. and all other supervised professional and confidential employees, person in a probationary or temporary status, employee, blah, blah, blah. So, I mean, right here in the union contract, it says that is not the case.
Probably the SEA contract?
No, this is the Teamsters at 14 to 16, the last one they had.
It's not the DPW contract, it's the Teamsters.
Well, and in another place in the contract, it says it talks about that. There's a vacant position.
Yes.
Other Teamsters have to fill.
Yeah.
Have the first choice to fill it, and they've elected to fill it. They're exercising their right. It's like when I post overtime, I have to post it for the whole department.
Yeah.
And the qualified person has the first right of refusal, if you will, and then it goes down from there.
Call the list. Yeah. Okay, just real quick.
Real quick, okay. Last year you had a warrant article. You wanted to build a washdown facility, and you also had a valve you wanted to replace, and there was at least one other thing in there. Those things, it didn't pass, so that stuff didn't get done.
Right.
The problem didn't go away.
Right. Right.
What are you? But you're not doing anything with it this year?
Well, I turned in 29 articles to the Board of Selectmen, totaling $10 million worth of work.
Yeah.
Okay. Realizing that not all of them were going to come this far.
Okay.
And you can see collectively we've decided which ones need to come, are the most important.
Okay. Okay, that's the answer I need. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming in as well.
The facility, yes, but we can't thank you enough for your hard work. I know you're both exhausted, but we really appreciate what you've brought into us. Are any more public works articles coming up? Do you know, Regina? I know you hate me to ask you about.
Not that I'm a public works. Not that I can recollect of. Right now.
Okay.
Vehicles. Oh, vehicle purchases. Oh, okay. Vehicle purchases.
Well, we have to I have to write them.
Right.
Yeah, those are.
So we may be seeing you next Tuesday if the selectmen take up one of the articles. And the, but well, we'll do you. Chris, if we bring you in, we'll do you first. We'll do you early. And does Regina or Fred have just a number? I know you don't want to talk to me about Warren articles. Do you have a number of how many articles you'll be looking at Monday night?
Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
Thank
you. No, we've worked our way through the first 11 here.
Yeah, I know.
The 12. Do you have
the rest.
It's 11. Because a number have already been thrown out.
And there's some on hold, right?
Four?
No.
Another 30.
20 total.
Yeah.
Good grief. Okay, well, we're going to be busy next Tuesday. And we will watch.
Well, all of them don't apply to us either.
Well, I'm talking about budget committee warrant and special money article.
20.
May I make a motion to adjourn?
Well, wait
yes.
One second.
I'll second it.
Wait. Okay. I hope we don't have to revise the confounded schedule again. But I thank all of you for your patience. And we're going to try to get through the final clump of budget committee related special money articles next Tuesday.
Okay,
thank
make a
you
motion
to
resign.
Thank you for the control room, Mr. LaBranche.
I mean, what was the motion? Not resign. What was it?
To adjourn?
Adjourn. Yeah. Okay. Anybody second this?
Adjourn.
Second.
Okay. Mr. Henderson seconded at what hour?
At 9:47.
9:47 p.m. Thank you.
Thank you very much.